I'll look for a motion in reference to the...
Make a motion that we seal the minutes of the non-public.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, Mr. Malinowski, I'll ask for a vote.
Counsel Levy.
Aye.
Counsel Bergeron.
Aye.
Counsel Zink.
Aye.
Counsel Nazaro.
Aye.
Counsel Bodman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Just as a point of reference, Counselor Bentley will not be here this evening. He is out of town. First thing we have to do is approval of the June 1st, 2011 business meeting minutes.
You're going to pledge allegiance?
Want to do that?
Yes, we will do that. Starting the meeting the other way.
Okay.
Pledge allegiance, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you for reminding me about that. First item is approval of minutes. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minutes of June 1st.
Second.
Any discussion or changes? Seeing none, I'll ask Mr. Malinowski for the vote.
Counsel Levy.
Aye.
Counsel Bergeron.
Aye.
Counsel Zink.
Aye.
Counsel Nazaro.
Aye.
Counsel Bodman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Just as a point of reference, Jen, very nice job on the minutes. Okay, next item is a presentation by Dale Bishop from Hydro Renewable Resources. Good evening.
Good evening, gentlemen. Very much appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak with you this evening, and I'll try and be concise and stay within the time limit, although the clock's over my shoulder, so there you are. Can you hear me a little better? As I was introduced, I'm Dale Bishop, and I'm the president of Hydra Renewable Resources. And we are generally seen as a company that deals in the design of wastewater treatment facilities. In fact, that's a bit of a misnomer, because in fact we are in the business of creating water and energy utilities, and we do that by treating wastewater. We're a little bit different than the norm that has been the case here in America and in Canada, where I'm from, for the last 150 years. We have been for 150 years concerned about preserving and enhancing public health. It's why we treat wastewater. And basically, in that model, what we've been doing is treating the water good enough that we can throw it away. So we try and clean it up so that it's no longer a public hazard and then flush it. That model has changed very little over the last 150 years. The only distinction has been the government's definition of good enough. And I think you're all painfully aware of the fact that the government's now got a good enough definition of nitrogen that's causing everybody a lot of angst in the Great Bay. We see that paradigm as one that has lost its time and lost its place. And in fact, wastewater isn't something to be thrown away. Wastewater is a resource, and it's a resource that can be harvested, and that's what we specialize in doing. We in fact look to take that whole paradigm and turn it on its head. Take wastewater from a 20 or 30 year cost sink for municipalities that run their own system and turn it into a profit center that has a 5 to 6 year payback. A payback isn't a term that's normally associated with wastewater treatment, but it is with the way in which we try and go about it. The very first thing we do is recognize that water is a resource that ought not to be thrown away. Somebody the other day said to me that waste is just a design flaw. And in fact, that's exactly the way we see it. If you're throwing it away, you've done something wrong. Go back and review what you're doing. We all recognize that water is valuable, Every one of you, everyone in this room pays for water, whether it's quarterly basis or monthly or whatever. We sell, as municipalities and as groups, we sell potable water. The problem with all of that is that, of course, we tend to flush our toilets with potable water. I'll skip the joke at this point, but anyway. And we water our lawn with potable water. We do all sorts of things with potable water. Nice stuff. But we sure don't need potable water to flush the toilet. What we do need is water that has been cleaned up to a standard that's acceptable in the most stringent environment in the world, that can be recycled and used for those secondary purposes. And that's exactly what we do. The very first thing we do is treat water to a standard that exceeds the most stringent standard anywhere in the world. California has one of the toughest standards, really the toughest standard in the U.S., called Title 22. And we treat water to a point that is twice as good as is required by Title 22. And we use that water then as a recyclable commodity. We sell it back into the system. We sell it at a discount. Why pay for potable water to flush your toilet when you can get cheaper water that is perfect for the purpose and can be used as such? So the first thing we do is take all of that water and discharge none of it. We look to sell all of it back into a system. The second thing we do is deal with sludge. It doesn't matter how you treat wastewater, whether you do as most do in Canada and America, and that is use an activated sludge system, or whether you're using a trickling filter or go through any one of 5 or 10 other technology alternatives, they all produce sludge. And in the end, that sludge is the bane of the existence of the wastewater treatment plant manager. Every day, he's got to find somebody to haul it away. Every day, he's trying to get it dry enough that he's not paying to haul water. Every day, he pays a fee to tip it into a local landfill, or if you're lucky enough to live in California, tip it into Arizona's landfill because California won't take it anymore. California, they pay $168 a ton to haul that stuff away every day. Here in New England, $50, $60, $70 a ton is closer to the average. That's a big cost. What we knew from the very beginning was that sludge isn't an ugly commodity that needs to be thrown away. It's a valuable commodity that is high in VOCs, called volatile organic compounds. That means it's rich in organic matter, and it has a very real place in creating a renewable resource. We take the sludge, we dry it, and we use it as fuel. Oddly enough, when sludge is dried to the point where it's 90% dry matter and only 10% water, it has the BTU value of middle-grade coal. Not bad stuff. We use it then to fire a pyrolytic reactor, talk about what that is later, generates methane, and we use the methane to generate electricity. In fact, we generate enough electricity to take the whole of the wastewater treatment facility off the grid. And most people don't recognize that wastewater treatment is one of the biggest sectoral users of electrical power in North America. $4 billion a year paid in electric bills alone to treat wastewater. So we take that sludge, we turn it into electricity, and we take the facility off the grid and eliminate that cost. We eliminate the cost of transporting the sludge. But the beauty of it is that we're able to generate much more electricity than we need just to run the facility. So we sell green power back into the grid. It's a second source of revenue for what we do. The third thing we do is recognize that wastewater is pretty warm. I know most guys haven't stuck their finger in it, but, you know, when you stop and think about it, it's coming from pretty warm engines. All of us are 98.6, thanks very much. And then at night, after you've boiled the spaghetti, you're throwing that down the drain and all of the stuff. And as a matter of fact, wastewater shows up at your facility here every day at somewhere between 50 and 60 degrees Fahrenheit. From a heat recovery perspective, that's a gold mine. And that's exactly what we do. We recover the heat in the wastewater stream exactly the way you'd recover heat in a geothermal application where you're sending a closed loop pipe. Two radiators interlocked, pass the wastewater through one of them and pick up the heat in the other. And in so doing, we generate a tremendous amount of energy that can be used then in a DESS, District Energy Shared System, a system where you're circulating heated fluid, water, and you're taking it out of the system with standard heat pumps available off the shelf at Lowe's down here, whatever the local building supply company is. Standard technology coming on. All of that to remind us that every municipality in this country, every municipality in Canada, every day throws away enough energy to supply the heating, cooling, and hot water needs for 20% of their municipality. I mean, think of it in the context, not necessarily here, but standing in New York City, where energy costs have gone through the ceiling and everybody's a woe is me, how will we ever pay for it? And every day they're flushing 20% of the energy they need to run that city. So we recover that energy and we use it in a district energy system. All of that sounds pretty far-fetched, except that all we're doing is replicating a system that was implemented in North America 2 years ago in Whistler, British Columbia, where when they set up for the Winter Olympics, they decided they'd be green and sustainable. And so they took the wastewater flow from the city of Whistler and they extracted the heat from it, and they used that to provide all of the heating, cooling, and hot water for 1 million square feet of residential accommodation that initially housed athletes and now houses people in their private condominiums. This is all technology and all systems that exist now and are in operation in their bits and pieces all over the place. Wastewater technology we use was developed in Norway 70 years ago, but it's been sold and implemented in hundreds of instances in the United States for the last 30 years. The pyrolytic reactor technology that we use, if you've ever bought a bag of charcoal, you got it from a pyrolytic reactor, in effect. British came up with it 225 years ago and have been lording it over everybody else since then. The generators we use for electricity are General Motors truck engines, 7.2 liter GM truck engines, modified only slightly in the head so that they burn methane rather than gasoline. All of this is technology that is readily available to us. In the end, for a system, give you a local example, a system the size of would be needed to handle the requirements of Portsmouth, about 6 million gallons per day. You're looking at a cost of about $60 million to do that system. If you're looking at a payback of 5.9 years. And that's assuming you had to pay for the money at 9.25% over 20 years. In effect, after you've paid for the capital carrying costs, the operating costs, the chemical costs, the maintenance costs of the facility, in something the size of Portland, you'd end up with about $4 million left over every year before taxes. Always before. 15.3% internal rate of return, 16.8% return on investment. All of that is to say we take the whole of the wastewater paradigm, turn it upside down, and say it doesn't need to be a 30-year cost center. It can be a profit center with great advantage to all of those involved. It's sufficiently profitable that pension fund monies in the United States and in Europe, but to take the United States, are anxious to become involved in what could be a design, build, own, and operate environment where they're prepared to put up the money. and why not? 20-year money at 9.25% coming back to them, and what you're dealing with is energy sales and water sales that give everybody great comfort that likely the demand isn't going to run out soon. So that's really what we're all about, trying to take that paradigm, turn it on its head, and offer municipalities an option that they haven't had up to now, to take that capital cost of wastewater treatment and move it out of the municipality, to take the cost of wastewater treatment and reduce it for municipalities, to take the whole of the operating environment and the maintenance environment out of the municipal sphere, if they would choose, and operate it privately, but on fixed contracts where for 20 years, the municipality knows exactly what they'd have to pay for wastewater treatment, which starts at about a 20% discount from what you're paying now. Now, I'm not here to try and pitch and say please buy or anything like that, but I have one last thing to tell you in all of this. It's just fast, right? And that is that the system is modular. We can build it from very small to very large, expand it as it's needed. But the system deals with nitrogen. A good word. Everybody should. We've dealt with nitrogen in this continent by adding a lot of energy, electricity, to run aerators that give enough oxygen to let the bugs eat up the nitrogen in an aerobic or oxygen-rich environment. And we presumed that was the only way to do it. 15 years ago, some funny guys in the Netherlands discovered differently, but then they were from there. That stuff. What they discovered in every wastewater stream in the world, domestic wastewater stream, were a set of bacteria that ate nitrogen, but ate them in an oxygen-free environment. What they discovered was NMOX, anaerobic ammonium oxidation. And they discovered that no matter where they went in the world, they found these bugs naturally in the water, but the problem was that they were also a perfect example of Darwinian. They were weak, they didn't compete very well, and they never performed very well in normal systems because they were the bigger bugs outcompeted. However, Siemens, who got a fair reputation in the field and operate in Europe and here, spent time from the mid-90s through 2005 doing longitudinal studies on how to manage this and what to do with it. And what they discovered in the end was that if you fed them a little bit of carbon, methanol is not a bad choice, feed them a little bit of carbon, the bugs got big and strong and they became really good competitors. And when they did, they ate up all the nitrogen. So much so that on Chesapeake Bay, in this country, now, today, there are three facilities operating like this, two operated by Siemens, one operated by Parkson's, and those three facilities are achieving nitrogen counts of 1 and 2. Not 3, not 8, not let's find somebody else to take this bullet and do it. They're operating at levels of 1 and 2. Beyond what the EPA has said, and they said, sorry, it can't stop the damn bugs I keep eating. The point is that we do that as part and parcel of what we're doing. The very technology that's being used in Chesapeake Bay is the technology we use for wastewater treatment. And so I'm here also to tell you that there is great controversy and great concern amongst the 6 municipalities on Great Bay about what will we ever do to meet the nitrogen standards? Do what other people are already doing. Meet them inexpensively, and you've also got built into that an option to meet them in a way that has a tremendous impact on the way in which you're able to operate your own municipality. There we are. Thank you.
Questions? Counsel Bergeron.
So all that being said, we've been getting quotes of anywhere from $15 to $18 million for a facility to do what we need it to do. What would your rough cost estimate be for something along the lines of what you've discussed tonight?
If all you were doing was wastewater treatment, if you wanted to follow the old model of treat it good enough to throw it away, but we'll meet the EPA, and if you wanted to do it on your own, and you're saying, how much would my turnkey price be to put it in and operate it and make sure you've got one running? About $8 per gallon of processing capacity. You've got 0.8 million. You need some expansion place. That's about 1 million gallons of processing capacity times $8. Puts the system in place. That includes turnkey operation and the first year of operation of the system, training your people how to run it. It's not that difficult, but we always run it for the first year to make sure that everybody's clear that we're delivering performance and not equipment. There isn't much magic to all of this stuff.
So how come we haven't heard of it before? I'm not trying to dispute what you're saying, but why is this all of a sudden?
Because what we're doing is contrary to the way in which the engineering community has developed and has been doing things for 100 years in terms of current technology. We have a tremendously powerful, and by powerful I mean good, competent, capable of first-rate delivery. We have an incredibly powerful engineering community in the United States and in Canada. They're basically mirror images of one another. And that community works very well because we make each engineer personally responsible for what they're doing. Here you are, call a PE, a professional engineer in Canada, whatever the designation. Here's your seal, son. Do whatever you want. Just remember, your wife, your kids, your house, your everything is on the line every time you use that damn thing. So what it means is that the engineers that we use are very good and very competent at defining the future by carefully looking over their shoulder. You build what you know works, and you build it the way you know it will keep working. But it is not a community, and it is not a system that looks for or encourages innovation. Innovation's for somewhere else. So in all of that, the great engineering companies, Back and Veatch, CH2M Hill, name a dozen others in this country, are very good at building the kind of wastewater treatment facilities that we've been using for the last 50 years. And they have not been very good at looking forward and saying, how do we change this paradigm? How do we take a step to the side and redefine what we're doing and how we're doing it? We've got the opportunity to do that. I'm not hung up on the fact that it's been done that way for the last 20 years. I'm simply hung up on doing it in a way that we know will work. So we are systems integrators. I've got no technology to sell. We buy the technology from proven suppliers who've got world-class product. But we plug it together in a different way. We take our sludge out front. Most here, you've got a clarifier up at the plant and toured it the last time when we were here. It's the kind of thing that's there for almost every municipal wastewater treatment facility you'll go into on this continent. You put the wastewater in, you let it set in the clarifier for a while, and 25-30% of the solids fall out, and then you move all the rest of it into the activated sludge facility and you wait for the bugs to eat it up. Well, you use a lot of energy to give the bugs enough to do all of that. I said, well, why put all of the solids into it where it's costing us a whack load of money? That's a technical Canadian term. to treat them, and we take them out up front. We don't put them in a clarifier. We put them through a sieve. 350-micron screen, let all of the wastewater fall through, and 70% of the solids stay up there. Well, that's great, because we're looking for fuel up there, so we get the fuel out up front, and it's good stuff, you know, all called green sludge. And so when we go to treat, instead of putting 70% into the facility, we're only putting 30% in, and there isn't an engineer we've talked to who hasn't looked at that and said, you know, I've always wondered why we bothered to put all of those solids into the whole of the system and try and get rid of them later. But we had the opportunity to turn that and take it out using proven equipment. So we're not smarter than a lot of guys. We've just got some flexibility that isn't necessarily available to you if you're a middle-level engineer in CH2M Hill.
Vice Chairman?
I have two questions, but one's actually a comment. I think I've seen this technology on TV recently. There was a show on where, is this in use in California and Arizona?
We're actually taking over a facility where it is in California in the high desert. And it is, as I say, it's being used today in Chesapeake Bay.
Right. The other question, I guess, is, in this area, what are the permitting hurdles? Do you have anything in New England that is in process, or?
There are, the technology itself doesn't represent any new or extraordinary challenge for permitting. We're doing exactly the same thing as you've likely had explained to you lots of times. The permitting in almost every environment is an end-of-pipe testing regime. So put what you want up here. I'm going to stand out here and hold my cup at the end of the pipe. And that's where I take the water from, and that's where I test. And most often, the environmental agencies aren't all that concerned about what you're doing up here. It's just, it's your bet, brother. I don't care. I'm just going to stand at the end of your pipe and test your water. And so we represent no special concern for them. And the fact that we can achieve standards that far exceed their testing means that they come back and test a second time on the presumption that the lab must have buggered up.
Right.
That's fine.
One more question. You mentioned a cost of $8 per gallon for if we're just going to treat it and dump it out in the bay like mm-hmm. we do now. What's the relative cost if we were to do a closed system whereby we actually recycled the water and used it? Do you have any?
2 million gallons per day would cost about $27 million to build. So it's $11 a gallon.
Right.
But the $8 a gallon you bond over 30 years, keep paying for it, and at the end of 30, right. It was so much fun, we all decided to do it again. The $11 per gallon has a, in that small system, has a 5.1-year payback and makes about $2.5 million a year. So, in fact, the 11 is a bargain and the 8 is the costly one.
Right, because the 8 you're paying for every year also with equipment maintenance and everything.
Yeah,
whereas if you do the 11, you're able to recoup your cost by selling
the
water back or whatever. Thank you.
Councilor Lazaro.
A few quick questions.
Sure.
First, a comment. You made a comment about potable water in the toilet. I may not care about that, but I have a dog watching at home that's very concerned about potable water in the toilet.
Wait a second. That's the same one that was drinking out of the mud puddle.
Perhaps. Ruby's a bugger. How many of these have you set up before?
Have we set up? We're taking over the first of the facilities that we're running in California this year.
Okay, but yeah, so
2.2 million gallons per day.
So soup to nuts, though, you have yet.
Soup to nuts, no. Nobody set up one soup to nuts. All of the elements exist in disparate places. There are, in fact, Parsons has well over 500 treatment facilities that use this technology in North America, as Siemens has been doing. When we go, all of the pieces exist, all of the pieces are in the marketplace, all of the pieces are proven. We are simply taking them and plugging them together. And we're plugging them together in such a way that no one influences the operation of the other. They're independent operators within that system. So we're comfortable, but it's a fair question, you know. The answer to when can I come and see one working is the end of April of next year in California, where we'll be delighted to show you everything that's going and fully operational.
Okay. Total nitrogen, let's leave aside the fact that non-point sources are the majority of the issue with total nitrogen in Great Bay right now.
No.
Your literature says it can get us down to 10 milligrams per liter?
That's the general thing. As we have now moved Animox into it and are using the design parameters and design help of Siemens to implement Animox, we can now take Animox down to 1 and 2.
Okay, so you actually can get us lower than that, because the states...
Can indeed.
The states want us down at 5, and we're trying to fight for 8 at this point.
No, and to tell you, there's no magic to it. This is not black art. It's not anything else. It is a simple, proven procedure, and it is being used. The EPA knows it's being used because the EPA is jumping up and down and saying, hallelujah. They can really do it. And the boys running the facility are saying, yeah. This is a no-brainer, but you have to look at it in a different way than we've looked at it in the past. I can tell you that if we sit with nitrification, denitrification, and the way we've tried to treat nitrogen, it is a costly venture, and you will go broke trying to reach the standard, period. But that doesn't have to be the case.
Okay. Yeah, the other is probably more a question for Sean, just wondering how much it actually costs us as a town to... for electricity to run our wastewater treatment. We can ask, I'll ask that later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Zink.
I may be asking the same question, but in terms of your clients or your customers, with the exception of this one in California, there's not a Joe Brown that we could pick up the phone and say, tell us how this worked in your small town? So it would
not of my customer, but we're working with Siemens. Be happy to get your customer list from them.
No. But I mean, this would certainly be an adventure on Newmarket's part.
If you try and do it before the end of April next year, yes, it will feel like an adventure. If you want to do it after the end of April next year, then you can all come out to California. April's not a bad time for the high desert, and we can go and kick tanks and watch it do it and stick our fingers in sockets and go, oops, real electricity is there.
And how long have you folks been in business?
Hydra is, I started the partnership in 1999. Getting long in the tooth here.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Levy.
Hi.
Hi.
Is it Siemens or you, or how does it all work?
We're the system integrator. We are the company that takes responsibility for creating the whole of the system, implementing the system, and managing the system. So it's us.
So what is Siemens doing now?
We use different technology suppliers, not one job to the next, but we have selected and standardized on technology suppliers for the wastewater treatment, for the electrical generation, for the pyrolytic reactor, for the sludge drying components, that sort of thing.
So how many different companies are there involved in putting this whole thing together?
There are 4 prime technology or equipment suppliers. We also partner with a company called Mace Group out of Britain, who provide our construction management and project management for anywhere we do this around the world. So there's us, Mace, who are engineering and construction management, and then the equipment suppliers.
But right now, you haven't really done this in America.
You're right.
Okay.
We have not really done this in America.
So if anything happened to your company, who would be the provider of service for the different, you said there's like 4 or 5 different companies that are all
right.
Being, I'm assuming, you're integrating them all together to make this thing work, correct?
We do. And then we contract with utility partners to actually provide the day-to-day facilities management for the operation. and they would remain and are a long-established company in America and would remain as the facility managers responsible for maintaining and keeping the system going.
Okay. If one of those companies that you put together to integrate this deal had a problem, for whatever reason, they went bankrupt, they disappeared, parts, things of that nature, who would be the, you know, how would that...
Well, in...
What would happen?
In our context, we take responsibility for that. We take responsibility for ensuring that the system is maintained properly with the contracts we have with the suppliers and through the suppliers back to their suppliers. iPower out of Anderson, Indiana, provides the electrical generation equipment. They acquire those 7.2 truck liter engines from General Motors. And in the formal contractual arrangement between ourselves and iPower, we'd end up going back to General Motors if iPower somehow disappeared in the middle of it.
Is there somewhere in this literature that annotates all the different companies that you're working with? I didn't.
We haven't, no, but if you'd like it, I'd be more than happy to.
Yeah, I'm just thinking long-term service.
Part of what we've been doing over the last several years is putting together an array of partners who have the strength to stand and give confidence to those who we are, to whom we are marketing, to say, these are real people, these are real companies, these are companies that have full-on performance records, and it's all a part of building the confidence with the client. And fair enough question, but we're comfortable with the partners we put together that we can stand before you as a very strong, capable, long-term partnership.
And my last question is, do you have any entities in Europe that are implementing this system that we could call as a reference, or
we are as I stand here tonight, we are the first company in the world to integrate all of these technologies in such a way that we can do what we're talking.
Okay, so they really did. There's no place this exists.
Not until next April, okay. California, at which point fully operational system will be there.
What's the timeline for the town? Where are we on all this?
We're probably a couple years out, I would think.
Yeah, because they're doing the study now, right? So the EPA is looking at things, the state's looking at things. Well, so
state and the coalition will be looking. EPA hopefully will be joining us.
So we're not going to, in theory, be doing anything for at least 2 years?
2 to 3.
Okay. Well, by then there'll be some history on this company and blah, blah, blah. Thank you.
Councilmember Bergeron.
Just one quick question. You can give me a quick answer.
Sure.
Technology recognized by the feds and the EPA for federal funding assistance. If we were to go for funding assistance for this, as we probably will be, do they recognize all of this?
All of the technology exists and is recognized in America. There's no, the thing is, we're not using any bleeding edge stuff. We're just using equipment and technologies that have been proven, long proven in the market.
Essentially, at the end of the day, they're just looking at what the output is. They don't really care how you get there.
Yeah, in large part, that is, okay. That's a bit of an oversimplification when you get into the detail, but that's the basic.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, as a follow-up to that question, though, I think if you didn't say it explicitly, I got it from your presentation that you are possibly in the position to offer to a town like Newmarket the ability to pay for the installation of this in exchange for being able to sell the water or the end product or something of that magnitude. So in theory, it could be $0 out of our pocket.
Our preferred model.
Design, build, operate.
Is design, build, own, and operate.
Yeah, right.
Where we would prefer to approach a council such as yours and say, we'll put up the money, however much it is. $27 million is not a challenge. And we can do that on the basis of some fairly simple, straightforward contracts between us that help you stabilize your costs and know you can speak to your electors and say, here's what it's going to be for the next 10 years. We've capped it.
Right. That's what I thought. Thank you.
Mr. Bishop, I'd like to thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
I think the nice thing is, as Councilor Levy asked, you know, we do have time to weigh all of our options and wait and see exactly what's required of us. So I'm very anxious to see the California plant go online and get some feedback on that.
We'd be delighted to welcome you there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item 2, approval of an encroachment easement 165 and 171 Main Street.
Hi. I'm Ray Donner. The property's under Marie T. Donner Revocable Trust. That's my wife.
Okay.
She wouldn't be here. I don't know if you've seen the drawings. Really what happened was we're condoing the two buildings, Flora Venture Building, as everybody knows it, and then Rocky's Famous Burgers right now is one property. We're condoing them into Building A, Building B. Couldn't be subdivided easily, so the easiest thing to do is to condo them so they can be sold separately. Well, when the survey was done by Scott Boudreau, it was discovered that a little tiny bit of the bigger building, where Flora Ventures is, encroaches on town property, and the other building, Rocky's Famous Burgers, which I guess at one point was actually two buildings, encroaches a little bit more. It's actually kind of like a curve to the front of that building where they joined them. So it didn't pose a problem. We got approval from the planning board. They've stamped the drawings and so on. Actually, it was my attorney that said, listen, we really should make this clean. So come to the town and request an easement, really for title insurance companies, should the building sell. It just makes it cleaner for them, okay? How this happened, my guess, as being an old surveyor from previous life, and then civil engineering, is those buildings are 150 years old, plus or minus, dirt roads, so on. The town probably came through God knows how many years ago and said, listen, we're going to put a right-of-way through town, be it 50 feet, 66 feet, 33 feet, whatever it may be, and just went through town, understandably. Nobody really did any accurate surveys probably at that point to see, well, what's encroaching here or there. Maybe they did. When I bought the buildings 3 years ago, I bought them as a whole. We never had a survey done. We just said, okay, we got title insurance, no problem. It's just that now this came up, and to, again, make it clean, this is what we're requesting. And the attorneys put into the easement, should the buildings burn to the ground, okay? Worst case scenario, they would at that point be built on or off town property, okay? Back onto owner's property. That's pretty much it.
So basically what it boils down to is you're looking for an easement that was never officially granted previously.
I really don't think anybody knew.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, now when all the work went on down through, you know, Main Street and went away through town, I'm a little surprised it didn't get picked up then. You know, because I'm sure there was accurate surveys done at that point, what, 4 years ago maybe, give or take. I would not be a bit surprised if I'm not the only one. You know, this may come up further. You know, I've seen buildings, just talking to somebody today, I did a lot of work down in Yonkers in New York, and a lot of those buildings, the basements go right under the sidewalks. You know, I'm sure, you know, yeah, cities, a lot of times that happens, and it's like, oh well.
Vice Chairman.
In concept, I have no problem with granting the easement. This happens all over the place with older buildings in downtown areas. The deed, though, the easement deed, who wrote the easement deed?
I believe it was drafted by their attorney, and Attorney Richardson looked at it.
All right, because I'm just questioning the last paragraph of the first page, or the front page. I don't think that's as clear as it could be about if the building does burn down or anything like that.
Was it substantially reconstructed?
Yeah. by the, it says, if the existing buildings or pertinent granite steps are substantially reconstructed by the grantee or grantees here, successive signs and easement shall terminate. I don't know if that's, if our lawyers think that's clear enough, I guess that may be fine, but I'm not so sure that's as clear as I'd like to see it.
This went back and forth a couple times between the attorneys.
Okay.
I'm not an attorney. I just really said, okay, you two work it out, and they did. The town attorney and my attorney.
I guess my question would be, what would be the downside of not being more specific? As I understand what you're saying. You're basically saying that if the building was to not be there any longer, then it would, terminate.
Right.
So,
right.
I mean,
when you get into substantially reconstructed, your opinion of substantially reconstructed and my opinion are two separate things. And, I mean, it may not ever be an issue, but, if you put one new piece of granite out there, you could argue that that's substantial reconstruction, or you could argue, I could tell you that I'm adding a bunch of stuff and it's not substantial because it's only in addition to what's there. So when I see terms like that, it makes me question it.
Okay. You all set?
Yeah.
Councilor Zink?
I don't have a problem with it either. I do have a problem with the sloppiness with which this was put together. We don't have a town manager. We don't have a city council. And having this thing going back and forth between two lawyers, and they can't even get the titles right, is a little disappointing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I'd like to see...
Would it be best for the town attorney to contact somebody on the board?
It'd be nice to have the town attorney get the titles right.
Yeah. That's that, Councilor?
Yes, thank you.
Councilor Bergeron.
I guess in response to Councilor Bottoman's claim, it says the last part of that... That particular paragraph you're talking about said the term substantial construction shall not include interior construction or exterior construction which consists of maintenance and repair.
Right.
I mean, I know it's
right.
Vague, but I don't have a problem with it either.
If everybody else,
I wouldn't call that a showstopper.
Yeah. No, I mean, I just would prefer if we're going to clean it up anyways, get the lawyer to come
up. Do you have some recommended verbiage so that he wouldn't?
I'll have my lawyer put it together.
Okay, excellent. Excellent.
Can I make a suggestion? If this is a sticking point, a maintenance and repair doesn't really require much in the permitting department. So maybe something could be put in if you're looking for something that...
It just says all other work shall be considered substantial construction, then I think that would clear it up. Because if you decided or a future owner decided to put out two new granite posts, what's that? Is that substantial construction? I would say it's probably not, but you could read this, like depending on what side of the fence you're on, you could read it either way.
Yeah.
So that's all my concern is. I, if everybody else is okay with it, I'm fine with it. I just pointed that out and, move on.
That's it?
Yep.
Councilor Levy?
Sure, it's here, but how much space are we talking about?
Oh, boy. Are you ready for this?
It's like from that wall.
No, oh.
Where are we on?
It's at the highest point, Gary, at the most infringement, it's 1 foot by the length of the building. And
half a foot
on the other one, it's less than 6 inches on the corner of Essex.
So bigger, Exeter Street. The bigger building, what's called the Flora Ventures building.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. We're talking 1 foot.
Okay.
1.01 for a distance of probably about 2 feet. And then the other corner down on 108 is 0.41 feet.
Okay, so we're talking a foot or two.
Yes.
Yeah.
So just so I'm ignorant to this, so I apologize for my ignorance, but we're going to give an easement which says exactly what, that land is now part of your building, or you can use it and change it, or...
Use it.
Can use it.
We can use it.
Yep. You can use it. It's still owned by the town.
Still owned by the town.
And you can, now I'm starting to understand. So if there's some change made to a step or this or that, just to play devil's advocate, and someone gets hurt, just because someone gets hurt on it, and they say it's because of the construction or whatever, would that be the town's liability with an easement, or would that be the landowner's, or?
It's typically the landowner. That would be me, because I have an easement.
Okay.
All right, just like if somebody has an easement, like Public Service New Hampshire has an easement through the property, they actually have an easement.
So the liability would not be the town's, that's what I'm getting at.
Depends on who your lawyer is.
Well, the reason I'm asking, the reason I'm asking is because it's our, we're giving an easement, which I don't have, I don't really care, as long as I don't want to see the town exposed to anything.
Right.
Is there any?
I agree.
You know what I mean? So if we do this, is there a way that we can do it with?
There should be an indemnification in the deed.
I don't know the proper.
There should be indemnification.
Well, if there was any reconstruction, again, let's say the building's burned, there would be no town liability anymore, because the easement would then end, because then the buildings would have.
No, but let's say they don't burn. Let's say, you have to repair something, right? And something happens. Just, I know this is, but you never know. It's always the things you don't ask that end up. So, you change it because you're not doing anything purposeful. Is there a way that at least this can say that, any modifications to the easement that we're granting?
To the buildings that are sitting on the easement.
Is not the liability of the town?
Well, I'm sure there must be, because again, like, take PSNH, they have easements everywhere.
All right, well, that would be my, if there's anything I would do in this, I would like to see the town not have any liability at all, but that's just because the way I think.
Maybe I'm oversimplifying this, but I'm taking a look at it, and you're telling me we're talking inches here, feet at best.
Yep.
And we're talking piece of land that the town owns, that what are we going to put on that piece, on that 2 or 3 feet or whatever it is? So why are we talking an easement as opposed to just saying, we can work out some kind of an arrangement that this property is yours from this point on? I mean, does that... Why?
That was actually brought up. God, this is over a year we've been working.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's incredible.
I think it's very expensive.
It was the attorneys both said that would be a nightmare. They said the easement is the easiest way, the least expensive way to do it.
Yeah, that's the public way. You'd need to discontinue a portion of it, then have a public vote. You could do it, it's just a cumbersome process.
Well, the council, don't forget, is a legislative body, so we come to the council.
Right,
the council
and
would be
we
the
changed
one
the lot line out back here a couple of years ago.
And that's all we did, is held a public hearing and agreed that the lot line would then change at that point in time.
Right, but this is a public way, it's a little bit different. It's a roadway, a public way, you have to discontinue use of it.
Then in an effort to try to make this part of it as simple as possible, why don't, if the council's in agreement with this, we get the correct titles and everything put on this thing. We have a consensus whether we will or will not accept this, vote on it at the next meeting with the proper, information on it. And in the meantime, I mean, I know, Vice Chairman, you had some concerns about, substantial...
Yep.
Construction. Mm-hmm. If there's anything that you can come up with that would change that in the next couple of days or so, maybe get it to town administrator and then get a copy to Mr. Donner also, and just go, I'm good with it. I think, quite honestly, for what we're talking about, we are spending an inordinate amount of time and something that is of really no value to the town.
Correct.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes, as long as any changes, even if it is a foot, that are made, don't put the town at any...
Right.
I think if I would feel more comfortable if we didn't have any liability.
Right. I wrote that down, a liability.
I don't think that's unreasonable.
It must be a boilerplate thing that they do, because again, mm-hmm. utility companies have easements all the time through property, so mm-hmm. if they do it, it must be a little...
There's a pretty standard indemnification clause.
Exactly.
Yeah. So is the council comfortable with bringing this back to the... Mr. Donner, are you okay with us taking... Sure. I mean, in essence, I think you've got the consensus that the council is going to support this. At least that's the gist I get. We'll just clean up the wording a little bit, and we'll have a couple of weeks to do it.
So let me... I wrote down a liability. That was another one. try to say, do we try to say what is substantial construction? How do we?
We can work on that in the interim.
Okay. You folks will take care of that?
I understand where Councilor Bodman's coming from.
Right, and certainly make sure we've got the right titles and everything on the
titles
document.
Titles and...
Yes.
Okay, which you would think the town attorney...
So if you're comfortable with that, we'll bring it back and we'll put it on the business meeting in July.
Not a problem.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Malasky. Good evening.
Hello.
Which would you like to discuss first?
I guess we can do the mechanics position if you'd like. We put out the RFP, we received two bids. You guys got the spreadsheet there. I know we've passed out a lot of information on it, talked about it a few times, I guess. Talking with that, it looks like we're going to continue to keep our mechanic, but I answer any questions or...
I'll start. I guess my question would be, at this point, you know, my whole thoughts on this process was the fact that we were losing an employee through retirement. So it wasn't like we were downsizing within the department. It was a situation that took care of itself. And my initial thoughts on this was, why would we not want to try this? Not go in with a 2 or 3 year contract or a contract period with anyone. Just simply say, we want to try this and see where it gets us. And I guess my question to you would be, why does that seem like such a bad idea?
Just the cost, really. It's just the prices for parts. We get anywhere from 32% to 50% off below list. If we Dover can still get the government discount, so there would just be that 10% on top of. If we will go the other way, it's 15% above list for the parts alone, and then the hourly rates, the moving the equipment around and stuff. I think it's going to cost us a lot of money.
Vice Chairman?
I guess I had a question. My thoughts are kind of the same as the Chairman's, is that when first started this, I figured, why don't we try it for a while? But how many hours a week does a mechanic now actually spend doing mechanic work? How much time does he have? I don't want to say downtime, but how much time is he doing other things? I know you said in the winter he plows or he chases plows or whatever. He's out on a plow route and things like that. How many hours out of his 40-hour week is he actually doing mechanics work?
He does, we figured it out, he does about 300 hours of snow plowing time.
Okay.
So out of 2,080, 300 of that is plowing. And some of that he may be fixing something because he has to stop plowing for a couple hours. But to put a number on the plowing time...
And everything else is mechanics work?
Yeah, sometimes depending on what you get for an unannounced water break or something, if you need a person, he's been called in to fill a person. If you couldn't get, he has a CDL, so if you couldn't get a truck driver, he might have been called in for something like that. But as far as his time on a normal basis, he's either fixing things or doing preventative maintenance on the vehicles and equipment.
So follow-up, do they... Not just the mechanic, I guess, in general. Do the DPW employees fill out timesheets?
Yes.
So you know at the end of this week, you'd know exactly how many hours the mechanic spent fixing a truck and how many hours somebody else spent mowing a field or picking up litter or whatever. They break it down by like that?
We can break it down by the position, whether it was a seasonal person or the mechanic.
Okay, so you can track all that. That's, I guess, what I'm... question. You can track
the hours
for various items of work,
and we used to do that by the hour. I mean, if he stopped doing something for an hour, we actually kept track of that,
right.
And it just became very a bookkeeping nightmare for people, so we went away from that. years ago, we used to write down to the minute.
Okay, thank you.
Counselor Zink.
I continue to have a problem trying to, with the information we've got, decide whether internal services or external services are more cost-effective. And that's because of a question that Counselor Vardaman asked in terms of time. It's highly unlikely that any job takes 2,080 hours a year to, or 2,040, whatever the number is, a year to do. And I was hoping, quite frankly, that this is not a full-time job, that it's a somewhat less than full-time job. And the only way I could determine that is if we went to the city of Dover Fleet Services or Auto Excellence and said, if we gave you $50,000 a year to take care of our equipment, would that be acceptable? And he said, yes. Then I could compare it. I would know what my budget is. But doing it by hours because of the number of hours that would be put into it by our individual, it makes it difficult to make that assessment. So once again, if we would have bid it out, just like we would janitorial services, and say, tell you what, we'll pay $12,000 a year to clean this building, I could make the decision as to whether we should have our own custodian or not. I can't when it's just based on an hourly rate. And I understand how unpredictable it would be for you. I mean, I'm right there. But I don't have the information to make the decision. Not that we're making the decision, but I don't have the information here to make the decision as to whether this is a good deal or not.
The position itself, like I said, we did our best to off the timesheets for this past winter. It was 300 hours. The rest of that time, he's not, unless, like I said, if we had a water break on a Saturday and I couldn't get a couple of guys, I'll call him in to drive a truck. Aside from that, he's turning wrenches, whether it's preventative or fixing something that's broke. That's what he does.
That's our counselor. Okay,
thank you.
Yeah. Counselor Levy.
Just a little clarification on the proposals. Fleet Services, I guess, out of Dover?
Yep.
You said regular rate, applies during snow plowing operations. And then you said, or someone said, otherwise 4-hour minimum on call-ins. Can you just clear? I don't understand
in
that.
In the city of Dover, they have 5 full-time mechanics. When the minute they drop a plow, the mechanics are in, for, let's just say, the next 3 days. This was the example given to me. Until they're done snow plowing and cleanup, they have mechanics on staff 24/7 on a rotating schedule so that the rate they would charge us if they were to do repairs would be the regular work hour, even if it was 1-2 in the morning. It wouldn't be a after hours charge as long as they're plowing snow.
Okay.
And then the call-in is, if it was the middle of the night and they're not plowing snow.
But chances are, if they were plowing, we'd be plowing.
Yes.
Unless it was a strange storm.
That's more for, like, the cruiser broke down the middle of Main Street and they can't tow it. They got to do something to it, you know.
And we'd obviously have to get our vehicles to them, correct?
Yes.
Now, if it was broken down in Newmarket, they would come out.
If it was during a snowstorm, they would probably send someone over, is the way it was put to me.
And they would charge us for their travel time?
Travel time.
Was that defined anywhere? Is there a fuel charge involved?
No, it would be the time, but it would be the regular rate hour. There was no mileage or fees or anything like that. He just said we would come, if it was during a snowstorm, we would send someone over, one of the guys over, because they have 5 mechanics.
Well, that sounds pretty reasonable, unless I'm missing something. And then on the bottom it says government pricing plus 10%. But on the one in Newmarket, which, you know, obviously from a logistics standpoint would be closer, right? It said cost plus 15. Is that cost plus 15 off government pricing?
Well, we don't know what his cost is. It would be list. No, we can't get government pricing.
Okay.
Dover can get government pricing.
Yeah.
But the Auto Excellence can't get government pricing. I don't know what his cost is. It'll be whatever 15 over list.
over retail, over, I don't think that's, it can't be, Rick. It must be from his cost.
Over his cost.
Yeah, so my, I guess I'm just, because this is very hard for me to figure out. I guess my question is, what's the difference between his cost and the Dover cost? I mean, it would be worth at least asking.
We, for instance, we get, if we go to buy something at Robbins Auto Parts, we get state pricing, government pricing, we get 32% below list.
Yeah.
So if a part costs $50,
yeah,
we get 30% off of that, 32%.
I understand.
He's paying 50, he's going to put 15% on top of that.
But the question is, does the gentleman from Newmarket, does he get cost? I know he's not paying retail and then adding 15%. That can't be. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I don't know what he paid. You know what I'm saying?
Not for just for comparison's sake, it would be worth at least, I think, knowing that. But, I mean, they're not going to charge you fuel or vehicle time to come and service it from Dover. It sounds pretty...
That's only for emergency. We have to bring the vehicles over there.
Oh, we do. That's only for emergency.
That's only for emergencies. Okay, would he send someone over to help up?
Okay, so otherwise you're going to need to send two people
to drop off a vehicle.
Two vehicles.
Okay, it's pretty hard to compare. Just one quick last thing. Do we have to, if we did one of these, would we have to sign a contract for a year, or what's the timeline?
The contract was in the bid proposal, and I don't
think it was for 1 year.
No, how many years? It
1 year.
Up to 3 years.
So I guess
I would assume that we would have the option of going to the individual and saying, you know, we don't need a contract. We'll just do it. See how it works out.
Well, I don't know how the rest of the council feels, but I mean, theoretically, if our exposure was 1 year, we could. We know what the. I think we kind of know what the cost is to have an employee for a year, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
I don't know if the vacation was added in, as Al had asked about and whatnot, but we, you know, figure it's, I don't know, 80, 90 grand all in with benefits and everything. The last thing, Eric said he talked to a couple of different municipalities and kind of got different answers. I wonder if it would be worth asking the one that didn't have an in-house person what they spent a year. I don't know if it's apples for apples and the sizes, you know, very, you know, but
right.
I mean,
I could.
If our exposure is 1 year and you know, I know it's more convenient to have someone in-house. I absolutely understand that. My sense is, and I don't know if it's analogous, but when we used to do service at the store, it was great because we could, you know, take care of things right away, but we lost a lot of money because we took care of everybody right away. And shouldn't say this maybe on TV, but you know, now, you know, we use a service company, and you know, if they have to go to that area on Wednesday and it's Monday, they say we'll go on Wednesday, and you know, it's more convenient, but it's, you know, it's more convenient for the customer when you have your own service. There's no question. There's no question it'd be more convenient for Newmarket if we had our own mechanic. The question is, how much more are we spending doing that? And that's the unknown. So, thank you.
Councilor Nazaro.
My concern is less with the convenience and more with the cost of personnel would be if we end up having to park people around all over the place, which I think Mr. Malasky has talked about multiple times. So, to me, I would rather, I echo what several councilors have said, that I still can't, I feel like it's apples to oranges every time I look at the comparisons here, that I would rather just have a set of criteria. These are the criteria that we're gonna base our estimates on, and this is what our best guess is that it costs for an actual a year external and a year internal. I just feel like I can't make a decision based on the numbers that I've been looking at. And that's not to knock anyone. I think we probably haven't set out like strong criteria. I mean, for anyone to build it on. So that's what I think.
Councilor Zink?
And I guess I just to add to that, I know how difficult it is to cost staffing. It's difficult for every organization to do it. But I think we've got to force ourselves into a discipline where we can at least get close to understanding what the cost is. For example, there's no cost in here about running the facility. It's got to cost us something to run the garage. Well, I mean, you get those elements, and I don't think it's, I don't know if the word's fair or not, but I don't think it's, using this one example is unfair in some respects, because I know you need to get on doing what you need to do. But on the other hand, I think we need a better process for identifying this kind of thing. I really do. I think, I don't know how to give you any, even an approximation. I don't even have a gut feel. I agree with Council Levy. I'm for sure customer service would be probably much better. But I don't know whether we're spending 40 grand either way to have this service internal and external. So I'm not even going to weigh in on it.
I think that the one thing that we have to look at is the opportunity that we receive from the current individual who is the mechanic. You know, I'm just quickly looking at, if you take 2,080 hours, which is a normal work year, Rick says he works 300 hours at snow plowing. He probably gets 5 weeks vacation, that's 200 hours. So he actually puts in 1,580 hours a year. We have 85 vehicles that he's responsible for maintaining in one way or another, whether they break down or regular routine maintenance. One of the benefits that we have with the current mechanic is that if he hasn't seen a particular vehicle over a period of time, if it's a police officer's vehicle, if it's a fire vehicle, he goes over there, he gets the keys, he brings it back to the department, and he takes care of it to make sure that it's routinely maintained. That's not the same quality that we're going to get if we put this thing out to bid. That individual, I doubt if Auto Excellent or the City of Dover is going to drive over to wherever it is and say, I need the keys because I have to take a cruiser because I got to change the oil. He's not going to take care of that. He's going to take care of the most immediate needs. The tire needs fixing. The engine's not running right, whatever it is. So we lose the importance that I think we have of responsibility to take care of the taxpayers' equipment in the best way we possibly can. Newmarket's had a mechanic on board for I don't know how long, and I think that that's one of the things that we begin to lose is that day-to-day maintenance that needs to take care of. At the end of the winter season, Rick's mechanic is out there going through the equipment and replacing and repairing what needs to be done so that in the next winter season it's ready to go. They just have to check it and get it in operational. Those are the types of things that get done. That's not going to get done, and which means that in some cases our personnel is going to be doing something other than what we expect them to be doing, which is out maintaining roads or cleaning up the grounds and things like that. So those are what we have to. Is there a value on that? You know, maybe probably not, but it's an important piece to the residents of this community. Are we going to expect that the garage or the City of Dover is going to keep logs as the CIP committee was sort of pounding the table, said we want logs about when they're coming in for maintenance and how long they've been operating and things like that. I don't think we're going to do that, which means we start doing it in-house. Somebody's got to do that. So, you know, I don't think this is a good value for the town to take it and start taking vehicles out and giving them to a garage to experiment with for a year. One of the things that Chief Sear sent a letter to all of you, and we talked about it, and he said if the vehicle is going to go to somebody other than a town, the town barn, then he's got to strip that vehicle of equipment. If we're going to have to send the ambulance someplace, we've got to strip it of the drugs and things like that. So somebody's got to take that responsibility. We don't have to do that today. He can bring it because he feels reassured that individual who works for the town is not going to be playing with anything, you know, and that's something that's a value you can't probably put on there. So I don't really think that at this point in time this is a good idea to sort of experiment with at this point. That's all I have to say.
Councilor Bergeron.
Well, since I pushed the button, most of my issues were also resolved by other questions, but I guess I'd have to disagree with that. I think it would be a good opportunity for us to experiment with this. I mean, without causing too much pain as far as laying someone off, we have an opportunity right now to try it. And because we don't have clear numbers, we're not quite sure what it is. So here's a perfect opportunity to try it. And if it doesn't work out, we go back. But we can't do that.
because we're just going to continue on the same vein. I think that's disappointing to me personally. And I'll end it there.
I guess to make comments on a couple of the town administrators' remarks. As far as maintaining the vehicles and stuff, first of all, I think that is part and parcel of a driver's position. Whoever's been issued that vehicle should be taking care of it, at least noticing when it's due for service, when something is not right in the vehicle, if that person's in the vehicle 5 days a week or whatever. So, you know, that's basically the way that I maintain the vehicles where I work. We outsource everything. We've got trucks that run 50, 60,000 pounds of weight on a daily basis, do 100 miles a day, 5 days a week. So, you know, it's up to the driver to let us know if there's something wrong with it. It's also up to me when I check driver's reports to notice that this truck is due for service in another 300, 400, 500 miles. So, you know, bottom line is I think that some of the responsibilities lie upon the department. I also realize that this isn't a decision that the council really has a say in other than to recommend. And, you know, the best I can do is recommend that we give this a try. And that's my feelings on it, because if you don't try it, we've had situations in the past where we've been asked to support other changes within the town, welfare director going to a contracted service, which we've supported. And I guess as a counselor, that's all I'm asking is that you perhaps support what a counselor, I can't speak for the other five that are up here this evening, but what this counselor is attempting to do, which is to see if we can save money, and if we can't, I'll be the first one to admit it a year from now. I will be the first one to say, you know, this didn't work, let's go back to the drawing board. And I bet we'll still find a mechanic out there to work for the town of Newmarket. So that's all I'm going to say on it, and I understand where Councilor Zink's coming from. We don't have good numbers to go by. Maybe this would be a step towards getting us some better numbers. I don't know.
You'll definitely know what the numbers are by the bills.
Councilor Nazaro.
But that still wouldn't get us, though, is a quantification of what the preventative maintenance is providing. I completely agree with the chairman that there's the driver's responsibility. There's a level of responsibility the driver do preventative maintenance at a low level, but you don't expect them to be able to do preventative maintenance at the level of a mechanic. So I do believe that the preventative maintenance is saving us mm-hmm. money. I just don't know how much. And so, again, all we do is advise. So I would ask that whichever way the town goes, if it does move towards hiring someone again, that we devise a system of quantifying how many hours are spent doing preventative maintenance and potentially how that's reducing repairs on vehicles. I just think we just need to. I've said it too many times now. But we need a better way of quantifying this. Thank you.
Any other discussion?
Could I speak for a minute?
Sure. Go ahead.
I understand we probably don't have, you know, what the light bill consists of for this position and things of that nature, but I disagree with all due respect that you guys don't have the numbers. I gave you what we spend on parts for the last two budget cycles, and you can add 10% or 15% on top of that and see what that cost will be. Those numbers aren't going to go away. You know what he works for hours. 300 of it was plowing snow. That doesn't even count the overtime he works. And I think you have a lot of information here. Do you have every single penny that goes with it? No, you're right, you don't. But I can't give you every little scenario out there for this position. We save a lot of money, in my opinion, doing it ourselves. We've had a mechanic since 1971, for anyone that doesn't know that. Yeah, I've got a mechanic. And we have a lot more equipment today. And he's the keeper of the equipment, and he keeps an eye on things. And the drivers do report things wrong with the vehicle. And the cruisers, a lot of people drive them. And there are times where it's real busy and someone overlooks something, and he knows that hasn't been in. He goes, he checks it. It's those things aren't going to happen anymore. So I think you do have a lot of information here as to what it cost when we look at the cost. I disagree that you don't have a lot of information with this. I think you have a lot of information.
Any other councilors want to weigh in on a suggestion or going once? Okay, Mr. Malasky, vehicle.
Requesting the release of $12,574 to replace a two-wheel drive half-ton vehicle. It was in the CIP schedule to be replaced, which we were going to keep it one additional year. And we had a vehicle totaled a couple weeks ago in an accident that wasn't our fault. The one good thing is we are getting $4,394 towards this replacement now from Peerless Insurance. They do have one on the lot that fits the town's requirements as far as what it has in it, so we wouldn't have to order the vehicle. It has affected the operations of the Building and Grounds Department being down that vehicle. They're currently using a car to move lawnmowers and weed whackers and things around. Like I said, it was in the schedule. It's state bid through Groponi Ford, and just looking to get your blessing to get that funds released so I can tie up this vehicle.
We need to have a public hearing before we can release CIP funds. So we can't give the blessing this evening on this.
I realize you have to do the thing, but I was just looking to make sure that I could tell the garage that we can commit to this vehicle. We just got to get our paperwork in order, knowing you have to do your thing.
Okay. Councilor Bergeron.
Quick question, Rick. The 93 Chevy that got
totaled?
Yes.
When was that going to be replaced?
That vehicle would have been replaced when we replaced this vehicle. That vehicle would have, the 99 would move into the 93 spot, the 93 would have gone.
Because of the 4,000, I was just thinking that should actually be applied to that particular vehicle, but I understand. Thank you.
Set?
Yep.
Vice Chairman?
I guess a question not for you so much, Rick, is for Ed. We don't have a process of, I guess this is the first, when I got this package, it was the first I had heard that we had a vehicle totaled. We don't have a process for notifying counselors when there's a significant accident. I guess there's no policy, if you will.
If there's a significant accident where an individual is injured or something like that, or it was a larger truck, Rick came in one day and had indicated to me that the truck had been in an accident. It was being looked at, and I guess a day later he walked in and said it was totaled.
Okay, that was my yeah. Comment is that I just surprised I hadn't heard anything about it. Usually in a small town you hear stories.
All set?
Yep.
Councilor Zink?
This is a procedural question, Mr. Chair, or Mr. Town Administrator, on in terms of being able to commit to it before a public hearing doesn't seem to make sense to me. I mean, the public hearing is to hear from the public.
True.
So how can we make a commitment prior to a public hearing to do anything?
Well, in the past, what has happened is when a department head has come before the council during a workshop to request purchasing something, the council will listen to it and generally has taken a consensus and said, okay, let's move it to the business meeting, get a resolution adopted, and we will notice the public hearing and then go forward from there. that's been the process the council has used.
But unless I'm misunderstanding, Rick's desire is to go to the Ford dealer and say, we're committing to it.
What I would like to tell Chris Pappas is the council has to hold a public hearing at its business meeting in July, but should be a go, so that he doesn't get rid of that vehicle.
But again, I go back to the public hearing. The public may say, we don't think that's appropriate.
That's absolutely true.
So I'm just asking procedurally.
And if it doesn't go through, then Rick picks up the phone the next day and says, we're not buying it.
Okay. So it's not a commitment.
Okay. It's a conundrum.
Well, yeah. I'll know that you guys are on board with me on it. There might be 100 people here saying don't do it. That's what I'm just trying to get like a straw, you know, that we're all on the same page here type of thing.
It's a kind of commitment.
Kind
of. All set?
Yeah, thank you.
Councilor Levy.
I was just going to ask, I mean, could we go another year without it? Do we need it that badly?
We're it's affected operations. The building and grounds guys don't have CDLs, so it's kind of to send them out with a six-wheel dump truck to go do what they need to do. They use the pickup for the lawnmowers, the weed whackers, the little trailers, going out to all the different areas to do their things.
Just thought I'd ask. Thank you.
Vice Chairman?
I had, I guess, a similar question. Do you have the mileage report with you in your package?
The vehicle?
Yeah. It came with our package, and it lists, you know, probably about 85 vehicles, I think. Mr. Winowski had said the vehicle we're talking about is vehicle number 15.
It's
the building and grounds Dodge Ram.
The vehicle we are talking about is, yes, it is.
All right. Can I just throw a question at you? And it's probably not for you to answer, but if you look further down the list, there is a 1999 Dodge Ram that the rec department has. Is there a reason why we can't use that? Number 36. I mean, I can't imagine why the rec department has a pickup truck that has 60,000 miles on it.
It's the bus, the van, the passenger van, like the Club Chameleon vans.
How do you tell the difference? Those two are listed exactly the same. Model Ram.
Because it says rec.
So you know it's a,
the only thing
rec
has that's Dodge is the buses.
Okay. So that's not a pickup, that's a van.
That's a van.
That certainly would answer that question. Yes, thank you.
I was just going to say that I guess it was like the first year I was here, we had a van that was used by the rec department, not the rec department, the Public Works, that one day when they were down here on Beach Street Extension, a woman came through and ended up totaling that. It was parked on the side of the road. She just drove across and smashed it for us. We didn't replace that one at the time. Rick had come to me and said, you know, can we do something? And it's like, well, let's work with what we have. So we were down one vehicle at that point. At this point, we're down now. It would be two vehicles, but by getting one, we'll be able to use a much smaller vehicle to do the running around that we need to do. Thank you.
Just a follow-up question, if I may, Rick. Where this is for buildings and grounds, and you're talking it's not a four-wheel drive, it's not for a CDL operator, why would you go with an F-150 six-cylinder as opposed to perhaps a Ranger four-cylinder if you're not really looking at it to do the heavy-duty work?
Just, they go get bark mulch. They'll go get... They tow the trailer. It's just got the bigger bed. And then on the project they're doing, like.
Okay. What's the council want to do with this? Anybody?
Trying to be in Coover.
Speak at once.
Anybody? No problem. Game's on. Let's go, guys.
Yeah.
Okay. Then I guess we'll have to set this up for a public hearing at the July business meeting. Sixth. Thank you.
Can I?
Vice Chairman.
Can I just ask a question of kind of to get some more information? Could we just get a list of what pickup trucks we have and who uses them right now for future reference? Because I look at this list and there's, you know, there's pickup trucks here and they mean nothing to me, you know, who's driving them around or whatever, just for future reference.
What's that?
Yep.
Okay.
Just one last thing while we're standing there.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it was 2 weeks ago when he was here, we had a conversation relative to sidewalks, and Rick had talked to the council about foregoing the completion of the sidewalk on North Main, whatever it is, going towards the high school and the elementary school, and looking at Durrell Woods. And I was wondering if the council has had an opportunity to look at Durrell Woods, and any idea as to how you want to proceed.
Vice Chairman.
I've looked at Durrell Woods, and Durrell Woods is a mess, and I think the sidewalk in front of the school is a mess, and my preference would be to do in front of the school because that's a much more high-speed road than Durrell Woods. I do agree Durrell Woods is a mess, but certainly a lower-speed road than 152. That'd be my preference. Less traffic, and there's, you know, potentially there's more people walking, going, kids walking to school.
Yes, I have to agree with the vice chair's recommendation. Any other councilors want to weigh in on it? Councilor Nazaro?
I agree. I think higher traffic, higher speed, more children. Makes sense. Thank you, sir.
Anyone else? Okay. I guess you're free to go.
Thanks.
Next up is Sean Gregg, Water Sewer Superintendent, with all kinds of things to discuss.
First thing I'd like to say is that we will not be going to monthly billing. Let's enjoy that one. Apparently, the bulk mailing, we were being undercharged, so the rate has been corrected, and so the costs have just, it's just not cost prohibitive, it's cost, it's not worth doing. So that's for the monthly billing, so we'll be staying with the quarterly billing. The second thing is the water and sewer rates. 3 years ago when I came on board, we looked at the rate structure. We did a rate study. We looked at the rates, and the rates were changed to make it fair, equitable for people, because they used to be minimums. And we also changed the rates to promote conservation. A year later, in 2009, we had new rates. And we had system charges with no minimums. It basically equivalent, it made the sewer rate jump drastically, 98 cents per 100 cubic feet. In 2010, which was last year, we looked at the rates again, and the system charges did not move, but the sewer rate raised went up 70 cents, and the water rate went up 25 cents. For the sewer, for the past 5 years, we have been deficit spending. It means our expenses were more than our revenues. And for the past couple of years, we've been trying to move ourselves and get ourselves back in the black. This year, I discussed it with the town administrator. I looked at estimated revenues for this year because I didn't have June in. I looked at this year's budget for the water department. I know there was discussions that we were going to be a couple hundred thousand dollars short. That is not true. It appears that we're going to be anywhere from, based on estimated revenues, it's going to be around, if we spend our budget completely, we'll be around $6,000 to $12,000 short on the water side. The water side fund balance is in good shape. It's over $800,000, roughly $880,000 in the fund balance. So it's not terrible. However, this year's budget coming up is bigger than last year's budget by about $12,000. And the increase in the budget is basically the CIP. The year we're in now, the CIP was $307,000. And next year's CIP is $358,000. So that's where the money's, where the increase was. The other thing is that we just did a CIP plan, which identified approximately $5 million in projects that need to get done, that the council said they wanted to get done. So we're looking to match revenues with expenses so that we're not eating into our fund balance. That was the main goal of this increase. The increase for the water is we're looking to do 15 cents per 100 cubic feet. The average person uses about 1,200 cubic feet per quarter in that range. So on a monthly basis, they'd be looking at about $1.80 a month for the water. On the sewer side's looking really good. It's the first time we've been in the black in 5 years. When I look at the budget and the estimated revenues, it looks like we're going to be in the $70,000 to $75,000 in the black for the first time, which is starting to move our fund balance up, which is pretty much, it's pretty close to zero. Next year's budget, when you look at it, it's $10,000 more than the budget we're in now. Again, where did that money go? CIP. This year's CIP, we put $67,000 into the fund balance. Next year, we're putting $100,000 into the fund balance, which is a very small number when you look at how much we have compared to when you look at the water department and you look at the sewer department. The sewer department has a lot of equipment, a lot of lift stations, a lot of things. So I feel we're under funding that part of the for the CIP. We also have big expenditures coming up. We have a new plant that we're looking at doing, and we need to get the fund balance up. The sewer increase that we discussed was 40 cents per 100 cubic feet. So 40 cents times 1,200 is, that's what you're going to see for a quarterly increase. If you actually look, if you look at the monthly increase, you're actually looking at a 60 cent increase for water and a $1.60 increase for sewer, if you're looking at it on a monthly basis. The goal of the water and sewer department right now was to try and have, because we didn't see water and sewer increases since 2003 to 2009, we were looking to set it up so that we have smaller increases. So all of a sudden we didn't get, people didn't see this huge increase come at them. And I feel that we're on that path. First year was a 98 cent increase. Second year for the sewer was a 70 cent increase. And now this year is a 40 cent increase. So I guess these are, and if you look at it on the water side, it's about $16,000 for every 10 cent increase, $16,000 per year, additive income. On the sewer side, it's about $15,000 for every 10 cents.
So, Sean, your recommendation after all of this is to leave the system charge the way it is.
Yes.
Go with the 15 cents on the water and the 40 cents on the sewer rate.
Correct. Correct.
So I guess, Vice Chairman.
Are these the same numbers that we talked about 2 years ago and last year when we developed this plan? They're the same increases?
No, they're actually lower increases. Okay. They're smaller increases.
Okay.
Actually, at this time, at last year, we went to 580, and the plan actually told us to go to 640.
Okay.
So we're really trying to do bare minimum and get by with what we have and slowly get up to where we need to be.
Right. So from my perspective, I'm okay with the increases. I generally don't like increases, but we need to properly fund our water and sewer operations. So this was part of the plan, so I support this.
Any other comments from the council? Councilor Nazaro?
So we're in the black this year by water and sewer all told together, like 67 something, right?
For sewer, we're looking at about around $70,000 to $74,000 in revenues over expenses if the entire budget gets spent. On the water side, it looks like we're going to be a little bit of a deficit. It depends how it comes in.
Do we look at water and sewer together as a total, or we look at?
No, they're separate accounts.
Okay.
They're separate accounts. So, I mean, it could hit it right on, but I'm estimating June, because June I'm going to have like next week.
What happens if we don't have this increase? What is the impact?
The sewer side is going to have a the fund balance won't replenish, and the sewer and the water side will probably see a negative next year. And the sewer side, because the budget went up a little bit, the revenues won't be as high over expenses.
But will we go in the red for sewer if there's not a sewer increase? I know water, we're already in the red.
We won't go in the red for the sewer, but we don't have very much money in the, well, we basically have no money in the fund balance. Also on the sewer side, you know, I feel that we're underfunding the CIP right now.
What do we have in the CIP right now?
There's about $402,000 in CIP for the sewer.
Is there like a benchmark? This is my last question, sorry. Is there like a benchmark for towns this size, what that dollar value should be?
Well, the CIP is based upon the programs and equipment things down the line that we wish to purchase, and we're not able to fully fund it the way we wish because our revenues don't meet our expenses.
Especially given the fact that the state of New Hampshire is telling us that we need
we need a new plant.
Thank you. Thank you, Sean.
All set.
Yes.
Anyone else? At this point, my recommendation would also be to go with the initial change. So do we, as a council, need to bring a resolution?
Yes, but so what we've done in the past is had a resolution.
Okay, so we will vote on your recommendation at the next business meeting, if that's okay with the council.
Okay.
Next, Sean.
Okay, the last thing I met with Jeff McClure from Weston Sampson, and we actually looked at progressing the pilot forward for the new well, the McIntosh well. And the reason for this is I feel that if we do the pilot, it's going to really refine the costs, and it's going to really tell us what we need to do. So I'm going to have Jeff present what those costs are and what we need to do to move forward on that.
Thanks for having me back. Also, happy to report Bruins are up 1-0.
All right.
5 left in the first.
Good job. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Moving on.
All this right. Next time when you start that statement, say, if there's anybody here that doesn't want to hear, you can leave the room for me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I'm glad I DVR'd.
You don't want to miss the celebration being live. So.
Hurry up.
I vote no.
Get us home even quicker. Well, thanks again for having us. As Sean mentioned, we did want to come forth with the cost for the pilot study. And what this proposal that's in front of you represents is a continuation of development of the water supply well, the McIntosh well. Some of the benefits is that during this pilot study, the well will be run the way that the water department would run the well, whereas the 56-day pumping test was pumped 24/7, which is not a good indicator as to how the well would be run in the future. The town would also gain specific data on being able to assess the effectiveness of the electrodialysis reversal treatment process. We'll also be doing some blending on the side, so we have real numbers to compare. So you'll have some hard figures in front of you to make a better decision as far as how to move forward with this. And additionally, what this represents is that you'll have costs in front of you for to complete the well and the selected treatment as you'd like to move forward. So you'll have real numbers, whereas I know that was one of the items that was brought up in the past in public forum was, well, what is this amount of money and what's it for? And after completing this work, you'll know exactly what the benefits are for your water quality and what the costs are to get you to those levels. That being said, the proposal, as we walk through the cover letter that's been provided, it basically is to develop a pilot work plan for the DES for them to review and approve what you'll be about to undertake. We'd have to submit a temporary groundwater discharge permit to DES and have that approved, similar to when you did the other pump test. You'll be injecting water into the wetland, so that just needs to be approved on a temporary basis. It includes rental of the actual piloting unit, the electrodialysis reversal machine, connecting that up, construction of a temporary shed to house that EDR unit, so that way it's out of the elements, rental of the water pump, placement of that pump downhole, and also an electrical generator and the fuel to fuel that generator throughout the process. Coordination and oversight of the piloting procedure, including the running of the machine and of the unit, laboratory analysis of additional samples that we'll be taking. Many of the samples will be taken directly online on the machine, but there's some that that aren't specifically attached to the unit, so we'll have to do additional lab analysis. And as mentioned, it also includes the compilation of the data, development of a report, estimation of the costs for full-scale treatment, as well as nominal time in there for meetings with town staff and with council. So that being the case, I'd like to immediately open it up to questions from you.
Vice Chairman?
My first question, I guess, is for Sean. I mean, as everybody knows, this was on the ballot, and it received a majority, but it didn't receive the majority required to go forward. Was this work part of that?
Yes.
Yes. Was it always intended to be part of that?
Yes.
Okay. Where is this money going to come from?
I would be looking to pull it out of the CIP.
Okay. But that's not what the CIP is for. For testing. Right?
I mean, the other option is to pull it from the fund balance.
Which is what?
There's $880,000 in the fund balance.
I thought that was the sewer, not the water.
Fund balance has basically nothing in the sewer.
Oh, it's the other way around. Okay, yeah. I misunderstood. Yeah. Okay, okay. Yep. Okay. Now for Jeff, I guess, is this going to get us, I suspect that this is going to get us, if we did this, some of the answers to the questions that Leo Fillion has constantly put forward? I mean, how long is this test going to run for?
It's a four-week process.
4 weeks. So it runs for 8 hours a day, 9, 10 hours a day, and then shuts off?
Yes.
And how often are we sampling?
Some of the parameters will be continuous. They'll be online continuously. The other ones are only at specified parameter.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Zink?
I don't know anything about water or water treatment, but I've listened to the SAGR as it's continued for the past couple of years about whether it needs treatment or it doesn't. And part of that's going to be resolved from a qualitative opinion relative to water quality. It's going to be solved from what do we think is going to happen in the long term. And I already bet my boat on something, I can't remember what, but I'll bet my something on the fact that it's going to, the conclusion is going to be the water is going to be treated, personally. And that's not a scientific, obviously. And I don't want to spend another $140,000 going through this analysis and coming up in the very bobbing to the surface, just like we have with every other study that's been done. So I'm not inclined to do it. I think I already know what the answer is from my very scientific approach.
When you're doing a full-scale treatment plant, generally speaking, you need to do a piloting exercise before that in order to be able to do the final design. So this pilot effort isn't an effort that we're doing to better provide you answers to be able to get the approval through town. This is something that would have to be done in order to successfully design the plant moving forward and to allow DES to approve you moving forward with this water treatment procedure and this technique. So it's not something that can be put to the wayside. If you're going to move forward with this treatment, it has to be done.
Follow up?
Sure.
But I look at this, upon completion of the above tasks, the town will have a full understanding of the full-scale treatment cost and expected water quality from the McIntosh well, should EDR treatment or blending with existing sources be performed. I hear you, and I understand what you're saying, but I think this water is going to be treated based on everything that I've heard so far. And I hear what you're saying in terms of quantifying it, but I think spending $140,000 now to do that before we have the confidence of the vote of the town that they want to move ahead with this is not money well spent.
Councilor Levy.
If I'm hearing you correctly, and I just got on the council, so I don't know any of the history of the water, really. You're saying this has to be done anyway.
That's correct.
So how do we have a Warren article at $3 million and change, and it was big change? Isn't it 3.7? 3.4?
3.2?
3.3? Okay. Yeah. No, we're all around. We had a Warren article for $3.3 million to do a system that you're telling, at least I'm hearing, that we were going to go ahead and fund without knowing what we needed. Because you're saying this testing has to be done before we know what we need.
Yeah, and that was something
that...
It was always explained as a worst-case scenario, yep. That if we had to do all the... If we had to do all this treatment, it would fund that. But hopefully we wouldn't have to do it all. So it was a worst-case scenario.
So why didn't the Warren article... Why didn't the Warren article just put $139,000 for the testing to find out, you know, what... Why wouldn't that...
The Warren article also was going to pay for installation of the access road of the three-phase electrical power to go up to the well. One of the goals was to be able to buy the pump up front so that way you wouldn't have to rent it and incur additional expense on that.
Okay.
By the electric not being in, you have to incur the generator expense. So,
Councilor Zink has a good point in this case is, you know, if we spend $140,000, we still don't know that the people are ever going to vote for the well.
Right. Well,
and that's his...
Just along that point, if we spend $139,000 and you're going to do this test for 8 hours a day for a month, you said roughly, is that definitive? Is that replicating the use of this well in the worst case scenario? Is that the maximum it could be used, and will that actually, excuse me, give us an accurate, I mean, with no ambiguity? You're assuring us of that?
The way that the pump test has proved is that the more you pump it, the lower some of the troubling constituents get. So
they get flushed out.
Yes.
And that's
when they spike when it gets turned off. So by operating it in the same manner that the water department would operate it, it gives you much greater assurance that the water quality you're receiving is actually what you'll get.
But is...
Can I respond to this?
Yeah, would you?
Yeah, well, the question you're asking is a question that I think Chairman LaBranche and myself asked when we met with a bunch of people last fall and winter. There's no certainty that the water we pump today, you know, 10 years from now, if this well were to go online, that it's the same water. It's the same constituents in the water. It could be completely different.
Because it changes
all
the time.
Right, exactly. And it's taking water from various radiuses, and you know, water fills back in, and, you know, from further distances, and depending on what's in the soil and everything, it could be completely different. So there is no guarantee that the day we turn a new well on that the water isn't different a year later.
Well, so in the spirit of that, just we're spending $139,000. You know, when I bought my, I'm on a well, but my water was incredibly hard. Now it's very soft. You know, 15, 20 years later, it's completely flipped.
Yep.
So it's very confusing, you know, green lighting 139 grand, because you're really saying that after you get done pumping this for a month, 2 months later, it theoretically could be different. And if we put this Warren article out again and it fails, or it goes on a year or so, are you going to have to do this test again?
No, and I think the time frame that you just gave was a little
skewed.
Yeah, it happens over decades, not over months. It may change 20 years out. It may stay the exact same. That's not something that anyone can quantify. But it certainly doesn't happen in months.
But you're assuring us that this $139,000 we're spending is going to give us an accurate read. That's not what you just said.
Well, it's an accurate read for what the water is today and for a certain period of time. Nobody's ever going to guarantee how far out in the future the water is going to stay the same, because you have no way of knowing.
Correct.
All right, so my last question is, the article went down. So are we sort of going against the article by doing this?
That's why I asked the question, if this was included as part of...
Well, it was.
And it was, absolutely.
It was. So, I mean, in a sense, I don't know enough about the water to, you know, I'm just asking the question. The voters said no. Now we're going to spend, I don't know, what percent, 5%, 3.5%, 4%, whatever percentage 139,000 is, a 3.3. And is that, you know, in accordance with what the votes stated? And it's real money.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely.
What's that?
Yeah.
Mr. Malnowski?
No.
You all set?
Pretty much what some of the discussion took care of that.
Councilor Nazaro?
Yeah, I mean, I do know that we have a water situation. We need to find another source. I guess I just get concerned at spending the money when we are just not sure if a Warren article is going to pass that allows us even to go to the McIntosh well. So that's my biggest concern. Let me just ask a procedural question. Procedurally, can we spend money on this even though the Warren article failed? I know it's not the whole thing, it's just a piece of it.
Well, if I may, Mr. Chairman,
sure.
The article failed by 36 votes.
Right.
It obtained a majority, it just didn't obtain the two-thirds.
Two-thirds.
So the question, you know, that I would ask DRA is, with it failed by that margin on a two-thirds vote, you know, does it mean that we cannot move forward? And that's the question I can easily find, and I'll have an answer for the council at our meeting in July.
I think the answer is we can't move forward.
Yeah, you don't want to bring up Warren 8, do you?
Excuse me?
That was a joke. It's a little humor.
I guess my procedural question is, even though I'm not entirely sure I'm inclined to vote for this, can we even have a piece of what the Warren article was included in the Warren article? Even though,
I'll ask that question.
Thanks. Thank you.
Councilor Bergeron.
I think it's quite simple that it did not pass, so we should probably not pursue it until it does. And at that time, we pursue it. And meanwhile, we table it.
You can't do it anyway.
Councilor Zink.
Kind of an editorial comment. I think I wish we had worded the Warren article differently, because I'm fully supportive of the McIntosh well and getting it online. And I think we took too big a gulp of water by putting the whole process before the voters, then allowing the town council to make the decision once that money was allocated as to whether they would spend the whole thing or not. So I don't want to dissuade moving ahead on that well, because I think it's really, really important. but the fact is, I personally would feel like we failed to follow through on what the voters, whether it was 38 votes. I mean, it's the citizens that will have to bear the consequences of not doing this on time, but I think it's their wishes. Thanks.
Okay.
see if we can wrap this up. The meeting that myself and Vice Chairman sat in on, Sean, you were there, I believe. Mr. Winowski was there. We had in-depth discussion about the quality of the water there. And we were told by someone who had absolutely nothing to do with that water system that, and he worked for a private water firm, and he said that he, his company would not sell that water to the, to his people. And the biggest negative points that were made by Mr. Fillion, Mr. Fillion was in that same meeting and never made any points that evening. What my recommendation would be is that as a council, we instruct the administrator to find out if in fact we have the authority to spend this $140,000. If we do, then perhaps we go ahead and do this pilot test, because if nothing else, that will certainly, you know, put everything to rest, which I think is why this article failed, was because people thought we were spending money for a treatment system that we did not need, which is totally incorrect. So my recommendation is, as I said, that we instruct the administrator to find out if we can spend these funds. And if we are able to, that we also check and see if we can get a private firm to also run tests on this water, so that we have somebody else coming back telling us that, yes, you need to treat it. You know, to me, there's no doubt in my mind that that well is going to have to be treated. No doubt at all. So that's where I like to leave it, if the council's in favor of it. And I know Councilor Levy did put his light on just as I started, so I will allow him to speak. But if the council's in consensus of this, this is a process I would like to follow at this point.
Councilor Levy. Super brief. We won't have to do this again if it passes, will we? This test? I mean, are you sure of that? Because it would be, then that would be
disastrous.
Not good.
Yeah. Right.
So as long as you're assuring us that if we can do this, we don't have to do it again if the warrant passes and they say, oh no, you have to go through the whole testing again for a water system, it would be a lot of money to throw around.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, thank you.
I just want to get a clarification of what you just said. So we're going to instruct the administrator to find out what I was saying earlier, if this is even possible to have discussion.
Yeah, and then everything else, right, going any further,
exactly. And then we'll talk about everything else after we figure that out.
Correct.
I wholeheartedly support that.
Yep. Everybody good with that?
Aye.
Jeff, thank you very much for your presentation. And Sean, hopefully we can work on this, because I really don't want to see this 12 months go by without doing something.
The reason we brought it was because we felt that it didn't pass because people had all these questions.
Well, I think maybe the council needs to do a better job of selling this also.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay. You know,
we could watch the game and finish this half.
I was just going to say, there's one thing that we definitely need to do is the next one.
Yeah, no, we're going to get the agenda done. Okay. Yes, agenda 5, adoption of resolution 2010-2011-19, authorizing the town administrator to sign quitclaim deeds on behalf of the town council for the sale of 4 town properties to Newmarket Mills, LLC. And in this case, I will accept a motion, because this is something that we do have to address. Councilor Nazaro, was your light on for this? Or?
No, it was last time.
I'm sorry. Vice Chairman.
I make a motion that we approve resolution 2010-2011-19, authorizing the town administrator to sign quitclaim deeds on behalf of the town for the sale of 4 properties to Newmarket Mills, LLC.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. In the interest of following procedure, I guess it would probably be a good time to read this resolution. So before we get into discussion where we've got a vote on the table, I would like to read it. Town of Newmarket, New Hampshire, by the Newmarket Town Council Resolution 2010-2011-19, resolution authorizing the town administrator to sign quit claim deeds on behalf of the Newmarket Town Council and the Town of Newmarket for the sale of 4 town properties to Newmarket Mills LLC. Whereas the Newmarket Town Council established the Downtown Tax Increment Financing District to assist in financing the investment needed to attract new development, provide for employment opportunities, and revitalize the downtown village and mill district, and whereas the town purchased several properties that are integral to accomplishing the revitalization of the downtown village and mill district, specifically the Eagles Building, the Carter Riverdale property, and the former Rockingham Shoe Company and adjacent parking lot. And whereas the acquisition of these properties was funded by the excess captured tax revenue generated within the tax increment financing district. And whereas the Eagles Building, map U2, lot 365, was purchased for $369,000. The Carter Riverdale property, map U2, lot 57, was purchased for $325,000. And whereas the former Rockingham Shoe Company, map U2, lot 61, and adjacent parking lot, map U2, lot 60A, was purchased for $600,000. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Town Council now hereby authorizes the Town Administrator to sign all documents and take necessary action on behalf of the Town of Newmarket in order to consummate the sale of the Eagles Building for $369,000, the Carter Riverdale property for $325,000, and the former Rockingham Shoe Company and adjacent parking lot for $291,000. For a total purchase of $985,000 to Newmarket Mills LLC, including without limitation the execution deeds of conveying the properties to Newmarket Mills LLC. Given at the Town Council Chambers in Newmarket, New Hampshire, this 15th day of June in the year of our Lord 2011. I will now open for discussion. Councilor Bergeron, was your light on for discussion? Councilor Levy.
Just a few questions. The original purchase price was on the option agreement. Was it $450,000? So correct. I'm trying to figure out, because I added it up and it looks like, you know, there's no issue with Riverdale and there's no issue with the other property. Eagles property, those are basically for what the town paid, from what I can see. But the $291,000 is significantly less than what the town was being offered, or that the agreement was made with Chinberg at $450,000. So, you know, it looks like if you add them all up, excuse me, the original cost was $1,294,000, if I added right. I did it by hand, so I could have been wrong. And it looks like we're going to be losing $309,000. And then I guess there was some insurance for a building that burned down at $125,000, which I don't really know if that has any bearing on this, but why aren't we keeping the original price with Chinberg at $450,000?
Because basically the council last year, I believe it was, had a appraisal done on the property, at which that's what the appraisal came back at, and it was decided by a vote of the council to go ahead and sell the property at that price, the $291,000, I believe it was. Vice Chairman.
I part of it, I think, Gary, is what you should do is get the whole, if you don't have the whole agreement with Newmarket LLC on the parking lot property, that may be in there, I'm not sure it is. The real driving factor for me was that he has the terms of his lease, and it goes up to like a 60-year lease. He's paying the
50 with a 10-year option.
Yeah, he's paying the town virtually nothing. And he said, I'll continue to pay that to you, and I'll lease it for 50 years, 60 years, and
and the council at the time decided that we'd rather get $291,000 now than get the small amount that we were going to get every year from him. So that was a driving factor, was that he basically said, I'd like to buy it, but I'll continue paying the lease if we can't, you know, get it at what is a more reasonable market rate. So that's the way I remember it going.
Okay. Can I follow up with just two more quick questions? The valuations in 08, was that actually an appraisal that was done, or a town, you know, a town valuation? Did they actually go out and get a real valuation on that property? Because what I saw...
No, it was a town. It was a town...
Yeah, so that wasn't really going out and getting a...
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
I just want to be clear on that.
Number six on that option agreement, it talked about, and I wish more of that information was here, because, you know, because when I saw that, I didn't, you know, have a background, but... In that option agreement, it said there was reserving parking spaces, and there are some restrictive covenants, and there was supposed to be 20 parking spaces for the general public, and there's also language addressing a minimum parking requirements. Is that going to still be part of this deal?
Yes.
Okay.
And actually, the entrance was being shifted over to allow for additional room, property for the library, if I'm not mistaken, for future expansion. Which was also in that document.
Okay. And then my last question. It says in the default, if the optionee shall fail to comply with any material term of this agreement, and part of the agreement was the purchase price, the optioner, being not otherwise in default by the time set for the closing of the title, the optioner's sole remedy is to hold and retain all sums of money paid, et cetera, and it just goes on all the things that can happen if they break it. I guess my only question, and I just want to make sure we're in compliance, is the $450,000 of material change? Because it says in the default part of this, if the optionee shall fail to comply with any material term of this agreement, and right. Part of this agreement was a $450,000.
But he didn't default on that. Okay. He asked us to change that number, and we basically changed that number.
And that's okay for
absolutely.
Us to do?
Absolutely. Yep.
Again, because the alternative was to have him just continue paying.
I think it was $6,000 a year or something like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That was that didn't protect the town's interest very well. It basically made it so that he would lease it forever, and there was never any possibility of ever getting the purchase price.
Because it's his benefit to lease it.
I mean, you know I'll leave it at this. It kind of bugged me is we paid $600.
Right.
And we gave him for $450. Now we're bringing it down to $291.
Right. And unfortunately, that's what's happened to real estate. And it was either $291 or $6,000 a year. So.
And that's how we got the credit,
yes.
The tax credit. So I don't know. It just kind of bothered me a little bit.
Yep.
Councilman Lanzaro.
What year did we buy it for $600?
It's right here.
Yeah, I don't have it in front of me.
The town purchased it for $600, but then after that I'm not sure when the fire occurred.
It was $600 with the building on it.
Red Sox. Right.
'04.
Okay.
Right.
And that
so,
night. Okay.
Height
so
of the,
during the night
height
of
the
Sox
bubble.
Winning.
Right.
Yes. Absolute, peak of the housing bubble.
Yes.
Correct. And then it burned, and then the town used the proceeds from that to take care of opening, cleaning up the lot, and making it a more usable lot at that point in time. But at the same time, during the discussion that the council was having with Mr. Chinberg relative to the purchase price, the bubble was still, moving, but it was heading down, and the value that we came to was reasonable at that moment in time.
Right.
Time has now gone by, and who's going to buy it?
The whole, great example of why we should not be in the real estate market.
I was just going to say that. We say that often.
Thank you.
Council Bergeron.
You have to look at this whole thing, I think, from the history of the whole transaction with Mr. Chinberg. I mean, he, like you said, we bought it during the high time of the economic, you know, peak that we had, and the real estate prices were high, and then we had an enormous crash. And even Mr. Chinberg was having a very difficult time obtaining financing for those mills. And I think when we negotiated that lease, it was to help him present himself to the banks better. He didn't have the parking lot in his control, so trying to sell the mill project to a bank was almost a non-starter. Mm-hmm. It was the town's council's willingness to work with Mr. Chinberg, I think, that resulted in that particular lease. You know, you have to look at the history and the perspective of how we've been working with him over the years. And I know at today's day it looks kind of, you know, like we're giving the thing away, but it really didn't work that way. And now we're actually getting movement on those mills, and it's progressing. So, you know, there was a cost associated with that, I guess you'd say. And that was it. That's all I wanted to say.
Vice Chair?
Yeah, I guess a follow-up on that. To be fair to Mr. Chinberg, he just came and asked the council, and he asked us. I don't have the greatest memory on this, but I think his original request was to buy it for $200,000, and then it went to $250,000, and then we negotiated up to $291,000. But he certainly didn't hold a gun to our heads. It was, he asked us, and we looked into it a little bit and agreed that, and we thought that was best for the town. You know, and from my perspective, you know, we need to do what we think is best for the town, and if that benefits Mr. Chinberg or somebody else, so be it. But the fact of the matter is that the price of real estate has, as everybody knows, has dropped precipitously in the last 6 years. So, yep.
Councilor Levy.
I was just going to say, we also paid to clean that site up.
Yeah.
So it's not just six. We paid Mr. Manso, didn't we, to
yes, crush rock and clean it up and everything.
And that
yep.
was
yep.
significant. It just...
Yep. Sometime, yeah.
Right. Not to drag this out, but we just have to look at this from a pure economic standpoint, and that is a sunk cost. That money is gone and will not come back. So we have to look at what is the absolute best deal that we can make for the town right now. And if this is where the best deal for the town right now, then so be it.
Okay. Any other discussion? We have a motion. We have a second. Mr. Winowski, I'll ask for the vote.
Council Levy?
I know it's going to pass. I can't support it. I apologize, but it bothers me too much. Nay.
Councilor Bergeron.
Aye.
Councilor Zink.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye. Motion carries 5-1.
With the council's indulgence, I'd like to go from item 8, since I know that Mr. Daigle is sitting in the audience, which is appointments to committees or commissions. Is the council okay with that?
Yes.
Okay, so we will now go to agenda item 8, which is town council to consider appointments to committees or commissions. We have one applicant for Zoning Board of Adjustment, and it's Robert Daigle with a term to expire May 2014. Do I have a nomination?
I nominate Robert Daigle to ZBA membership with a term expiring in May of 2014.
Okay. Mr. Daigle, would you like to say a few words?
Not much to say, except that you guys lied to me. You said there was going to be absolutely no work in this, real easy. I think we had some of the most difficult decisions come before us, but thank you for appointing me. I just attended the Office of Energy and Planning seminar on zoning over in Manchester this weekend, so look forward to keep it up. And sitting in the audience over here reminds me that the topics never go away. We were dealing with water in 80 when I was public works director. We're dealing with water again, and mechanics, same thing. We had the same issues then. It never changes.
Groundhog Day.
Yeah. Okay. Did you? You're all set.
Yeah.
Councilor Bergeron, did you have something? No.
No.
Okay. Then with that, if there's no other discussion, I will call for the vote on Mr. Daigle.
Council Levy.
Aye.
Council Bergeron.
Aye.
Council Zink.
Aye.
Council Nazaro.
Aye.
Council Bodman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye. Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you.
All right, now we'll go back to item 6, which is discussion on dam removal feasibility study. Vice Chairman.
Can I just make a general statement on this? Sure. I know last time we met, we had a nice presentation, and we're told what Exeter is doing as far as putting together committees on this and that. And, you know, I think that we don't need to put together a big elaborate committee to do this. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're going to end up, if we get the funding, we're going to hire a consultant to do this. And I would recommend that at this point we just have the town planner or the planning office department manage this and see where we go. But, you know, putting together four or five committees for this, I think, mm-hmm. is you're going to kill it by too many committees. So.
That's right.
Yep.
Councilor Zink.
I don't know if this is possible or not, but the individual that came in and spoke with us several times mentioned the fact that Newmarket and Exeter's situation, I don't know if she used the word exactly the same, but they were
similar,
very similar. And I'm wondering if there's any way that Exeter and Newmarket can piggyback on this thing to save some expense. It looks to me like we're going to be doing many of the same things twice.
Exeter just signed a contract with a consultant to do theirs.
Okay.
See, my whole thought process on this is if we can get a couple of people involved in this to start doing some legwork and finding some of the matching funding that was discussed that evening, to me, that's the first step in trying to move this thing forward. If we don't have the commitments from these other organizations that were mentioned by, I believe her name was Ms. Loisel, at the last meeting, if we don't have matching funds, then, you know, we're talking $150,000-$160,000 to do this. So my thoughts were, and it was strictly my thoughts, is that perhaps, you know, this isn't really something that I would want to see the administrator spending time on, because I think, you know, he has other things that he has to deal with on a day-to-day basis. But if we could get someone, Vice Chairman mentioned planning department, that would be fine. I'm thinking if we could perhaps get Ms. Glover involved somehow and utilize her services, if nothing else, to get a committee going and see if we can get the funding. I think that's really the first step as a council that we need to do is to find the matching funds that are out there. So those are my thoughts. Mr. Winowski?
Well, I had happened to have a conversation with Deb Loisel today because she had sent me the PowerPoint that mm-hmm. the council we were unable to see. I wanted to see that. And in the discussion that we had, I said that the council would be talking about it tonight. Her suggestion is first for the council to decide what kind of a committee you want. She doesn't recommend, you know, if you look at in the PowerPoint, you'll see that Exeter has something like a 10-member committee. If you look at Milford's, they have six people that they have on it. And so she says it's for the committee to decide, the council to decide who you want to put on that committee. She recommends that she says to me that she's willing to work on it. She's already told their office, you know, set up an account for me so that way my time can be used to get federal funds. So that's first thing. Second thing is she says once the committee is established, that they need to look at the RFP and what their goals are going to be that they want to attain from the study and put that together, and then at the same time work to get letters out to get dollars coming in. Right now we have the Great Bay Trout Unlimited has contributed $500 and some of the information that we have from the deliberative session, that was a contribution that they're willing to make. But there are a variety of other organizations out there that can commit money to, so we need to get the process going on that count. So I guess, A, it's how big of a committee you want, B, who would you like to have on it, and then C, saying, okay, start working on the project We have the RFPs that both Milford and Exeter have used. I agree that to some extent Exeter is going to be similar to what we're looking to do. We're not so much using it as a water resource. That's one of the things that Exeter has to look at, because when they drew it down the last time, it impacted several of the wells, which means they are now looking at other resources for wells and stuff if it should come down. But she's willing to come down and work with the committee, so that once it's established, I think that she'll be a guiding resource for the committee as a whole.
I would certainly encourage having her as part of the committee, and I would support putting either someone from planning or Ms. Glover on it, and having a four-person committee at this point. If we need to grow it, we can, but you know, to me, I think the critical thing is getting that matching funding.
Yep.
And we,
because we are going to be limited by that.
Right, that's a good way to start. So I don't know what the other councilors feel as far as a town person being involved with this, but Vice Chairman.
I agree in concept that, you know, we need to identify the funding sources before we go and spend a lot of time and energy on this. Listening to the presentation and listening to the people that supported the Warren article or the proponents of it, they don't think that getting the funding is going to be an issue. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I think we should get the funding in place. And you know, there's nobody, I don't think there's anybody better in town to track funding and to deal with the state and other agencies than Diane, because she has relationships with a lot of those people already. And once we get the funding in place, then we can figure out what we want to do for a committee. And you know, I think we can take Exeter's RFP and basically cut out a few things and
like
send
Exeter.
It out.
True.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Change the name back to Innocent. So, I mean, I'd like to focus the effort, like the chairman said at this point, on let's try to identify the funding and get the funding in place, and take it one step at a time from there.
That's it.
Yep.
Councilor Levy.
Just so I understand, if we don't get the matching funds, because I think she said it was about $150,000. The Warren article passed for what, 45 was it? So that's 90, because they automatically match that. So we need another 60. If we don't get matching funds, which, by the way, 60 means 30. Am I getting that right? So do we really have the latitude to not do it if the Warren article passed? I'm just curious. You know, in other words,
we committed to $45,000. Right. We can't spend a nickel more than that.
Okay, so if we don't get, well, we're going to have to spend 30 to get 60, right? In other words, the gross sheet.
$45,000 we have is our seed money.
Yeah, but that makes it 90. They match that, the Fed, she said. So that
right now you've got another $500 with the trout. So it's another $1,000.
So she said the gross was around 150, right?
Right. Correct.
So if we're at 90, right?
Right.
They're not going to pay, you know, the other 60. We're going to have to come up with another 30.
Well, she's going to work.
Match 30.
The state woman would work her time in kind and get reimbursed for that. That would go towards it. So there's other outside people outside of the town that can.
That can add up to
30. Add up to the 30.
And,
right.
And some of the town staff time could be allocated towards that. So we could go to the feds and say, we have a total of $15,000 here of in-kind services. We're looking to get an additional $15,000 from you from this organization. And we can match that.
Okay. So what you're saying is if we don't get the matching funds, we just don't do it.
We have $45,000.
Yeah, we just don't do it.
Well, we do a $45,000 study.
Right.
We could do or not do it in one or the other. Or $90,000 study, right.
That's if we get somebody from the feds, a couple different federal organizations
right.
to match us.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Okay.
So I can certainly agree with someone from the planning department if Mr. Winowski thinks that they've got the time. Any other comments from the council? So I guess we see if we can't get some of this funding going. Okay. Item 7, Town Council Goals. Hopefully you've all seen them, and I don't know. I would like to see three of them be at the top and maybe three of them be secondary goals. We've got nine that I had listed down here that I've received, and I believe we received another three this evening. So, anybody care to start?
Go ahead.
Start, so you don't have to start. I think there's a lot of good things on here. To me, the two most important things are, well, I'll say the three most important things are the charter. I think I've heard from several people in town, and I think we owe the taxpayers in town the ability to vote on one day on both school and town things. So to me, that's the other, the second most important thing. And while I agree that, you know, we need to update personnel policies, I'm not so sure we need to make that as a goal. I would like to talk about item two, which is school and town consolidation. And that consolidation probably isn't even the right word there. I think it's just getting the effort off the ground and continue to make it part of the process that before the town, at least on our side, before we do anything, we talk with the school and look at ways to get efficiencies in performing the tasks we perform. So those are my three.
Okay, so you basically took one, two, and three on this list and
yes,
made them your three. Okay.
Yes.
Councilor Zink.
I agree with one, two, and three. One of the questions I think it's John that has brought this up on several occasions, and that is the to facilitate the sale or lease of town-owned properties. I think that's a great objective. I just don't understand what the magnitude is. I mean, I've never seen on a piece of paper how significant that is, and if it is significant, I think it ought to be right up there.
Yeah.
Because if we've got stuff hanging around that, so I would put that as a high on number four.
As a secondary, maybe.
Yep, but the first one on it. And beyond that, I think I would have a hard time. I think the others are all important. I'd have a hard time separating their individual importance.
Okay. All set, Councilor?
Yes, thank you.
Councilor Levy.
I'm all for the consolidation of the date. I think that's imperative. I was a little confused, though. It says if we wanted to initiate it, it says if the council wanted to change, that's what I should have said. If the council wanted to change the town's date for adoption for the budget, and that's because, and that has to do with why we have to have it in the timeline, right? There would be a few changes to the charter, Article 5, finance that would need to. Can you just explain that a little bit?
Sure. There are within the charter, there are several areas that talk about it.
Yeah.
And they reference certain things happening on the second Tuesday in May. So there are seven areas of the charter that we would have to go through and change it to reference to March, if that's what we were looking to do. And it might mean that we move all our voting for election of officers to March. So it's a matter of changing the charter in a bunch of places, whereas the school district only needs to do one thing. Shall the school district meeting be held on the second Tuesday in May?
They can't do that.
I think they have budgetary issues.
I gave the council, yeah, I believe in the information, yeah, that I provided you.
Yeah.
And 189:14A,
right,
which,
right,
talks about that.
Right, and I mean, practically speaking, I know from this year personally that they, if they are going to not rehire teachers, they have to notify them by April 15th.
No, it says they need to notify them.
But they, I believe,
if a teacher is not to be renominated or reelected, provided that no notification occur later than Friday following the second Tuesday in May.
If I may,
but I think their contract is different.
If I may, that's actually getting into discussion of the goal. I'd
okay,
really like to kind of just stick to maybe going with what you like to see as your goals, and then we'll discuss them at a later date.
Okay.
The only reason I brought that up is because I was trying to figure out how it was going to happen and how it's going to get initiated, because I got a feeling it's going to fall on the council and the charter, but that's just my thought.
Well, I'm, you know, okay. That's what we'll... But,
yeah, I'm
what
off. What
were your other two choices?
The only reason I brought up personnel issues was because I thought the town might have some exposure, which I think I put in my email to you.
Okay, so you're looking at number four as...
Yeah, well, I tell you, I think if the town knows that it's out of compliance on handbooks and personnel issues, I think it's not good. I think it should be addressed, and I think it can be addressed pretty quickly. That's the only reason I think it exposes the town to litigation, and I just think it's not a good thing to have, and that's why I put it there. So,
and your third choice?
The charter's fine. The changing,
number one?
You know, working on number one is fine.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Councilor Nazaro.
So I think that three, the school and town being done at the same time, to me is a subset of one, as far as I'm concerned, town charter. It's sort of like it's the same. It's related. They're somehow related. So I can't get away with saying one and three are one for my vote.
Okay, they are. Trust me, they are different in a lot of ways.
Okay.
But.
Yeah, I suppose 1, 2, 3 is where I would go. Okay. The sewer's certainly high in my world, mm-hmm. but and I would love to see the list of how many properties we own and what the valuation
can,
is.
Can you maybe get that for the council?
If that was really high, I might have a different order.
And it's not saying it won't be secondary goals either.
Yeah, I mean, just because it's not one of our top
priorities. We're
going to
get our top three tonight, and then we'll come back with our secondaries at the next meeting. That's okay.
I will talk more at the next meeting. Thank you.
Councilor Bergeron?
Okay, number one, in my opinion, would be update personnel policies. I think that's been proven to us this last year that we really need to work on those. Review the town charter would be number two. And once again, it's lacking in some areas. We found that it's outdated, not necessarily following state RSAs. And three would be working on having the same voting day for efficiency.
Okay. And I would go with number one, which is review the town charter. Number three, which is the one-day vote. And number four, which is the policy, because I do think that is important. To be in line and in compliance. So that's what we've got. At this point, it looks like one and three is definitely a goal that we're going to pursue. I don't have a problem with doing the first four and seeing if we can't, but putting the focus on one and three and then two and four, you know, we can obviously work on if everybody's good with that.
Yes.
And then if we can come back at the business meeting and come up with our secondaries. I mean, there's a lot of work there. That's stuff that's definitely going to take some time to do. But by that time, everybody should have a list of the town-owned property, so it'll make that one a little bit easier to understand. So if everybody's good, we'll go 1 through 4 as goals, with 1 and 3 being priorities. Councilor Levy.
So, and just in closing, so we'll discuss all this at the business meeting, correct?
Yeah, you know, obviously we want to probably discuss one of these at a time.
Yeah,
so because there will be some discussion.
Okay, good.
But yes, Mr. Winowski, for the business meeting, we can certainly put in number one as discussion on that goal.
Okay.
Because it's there. That's one of our goals. Okay, does that answer
right.
you?
Right, yeah.
Okay, anything else, anyone else? Okay, we'll go past number 8 since we did that already. Number 9 is review of minutes for standing committees and council representatives. I'll push this off to the workshop if the council's in agreement.
Yep.
Okay. Did I say the workshop or did I say the business meeting?
Business.
We'll do it for the business meeting.
Number 10 is old new business. Anybody with any old business? Anybody with any new business? Councilor Bergeron.
Well, since I didn't get to give my report where I was going to mention something, I'm going to mention it now. In our Conservation Commission meeting the other night, we have a girl who is associated with UNH, and she knows an expert on nitrogen. And was one, we were at the Conservation Commission wondering about nitrogen and its impact, and she was going to set up a talk for us for our own edification. And it was suggested that perhaps the council might want to piggyback on that. So I just wanted to know your opinion on that and whether you'd be interested in that, and I can try to set that up. If not, if you've heard enough about nitrogen, that's fine too.
I would certainly encourage that the Conservation Commission set up the meeting for the Thursday night, or any other night for that fact, and then whatever councilors want to attend would be more than welcome, and I would certainly be there if I'm in the area, for sure.
I guess because of the weighty issues associated with it, you know, maybe we should have a good education on what nitrogen actually does, I guess, as the discussion was.
No pun intended.
That's correct.
So if you can just tell them to set it up and let us know, give us fair warning so we can schedule
I will
in.
Do so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Everybody good with that?
Absolutely.
Anyone else for new business? I do have. I just want to read into the record a letter that I received from the Stratford Regional Planning Commission, and I just want to make note of it because I think it should be noted. It's to Chairman Michael LaBranch, Town of Newmarket, Newmarket, New Hampshire, Stratford Regional Planning Commissioner McMiniman. Dear Chairman LaBranch and councilors, on behalf of the Stratford Regional Planning Commission Executive Committee, I am writing to express our appreciation and thanks for Mr. Frederick Rick McMiniman's outstanding tenure with the Commission. Rick presented the Town of Newmarket at the Commission and Metropolitan Planning Organizational's Policy Committee and was elected to serve as a member of the Executive Committee for 2 years. Everyone serving with Rick appreciated his thorough preparation, diligent reviewing meeting minutes and draft documents and budgets, and his thoughtful questions and quick humor. In a relatively short time frame, he made substantial contributions to the business of the Commission. Additionally, he represented the Town of Newmarket in the best sense, increasing the visibility and role of the town in regional projects and issues. With best regards to the Town of Newmarket and Mr. McMiniman, Cynthia Copeland, Executive Director. So I just thought that that should be noted. And the only other thing I wanted to bring up is something that Councilor Bentley had sent me an email on. I know when we did our site walk the other day at the Wilson property, there was discussion about haying the field and everything. And before we do any mowing, we're going to take care. Okay, so as he talked.
No, he hasn't.
You're not
going to
do that. No, we've done that before. But anyway, before we go and do any.
Let's give him $5,000.
Before we go and pay anybody to do it, if we could just, maybe if you could just.
Could you shoot me that email?
I can give it to you.
That was great.
Okay. Because I did tell him that I would mention it because there was something that he wanted to talk about. So. And that's all that I have. Councilor Bergeron, are you on?
I'm sorry, but I kind of missed the first part of your statement. Were you talking about Haying, Wigan Farm, and et cetera?
No, Wilson Farm.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. Because we have actually a very specific plan for haying that because of the species that are involved. So, okay. Never mind.
All right, next meeting.
Thanks. It was.
Okay, so we've got that done. So I think now we are, if there's no other new business, town administrator's report.
There's only really one thing that I really need to bring up.
Good.
A gentleman by the name of Jason Michaels, who runs the, I forget what the name of the shop is, Cornerstone Jewelry here in town, came in yesterday, and I've given you all a letter that he presented me. He would like to do a Newmarket Sidewalk Chalk Art Festival. He'd like to do it on Saturday, June 25th, and it would go from 9 a.m. till sunset. He's counted approximately 72 squares within the downtown area. that would be available to be chalked out. Some of the areas would be like a 2 by 4 foot area, and others would be a 4 by 4. He's looking to raise money for the purposes of promoting some programs that they are looking to do, basically for arts education. And he's just would like to know from the council that they have a problem with him moving forward on that. One of the things I mentioned to him was that he needs to be able to allow space for pedestrians to walk through there, but that I would present that to the council and get some feedback as to how you feel about that.
Vice Chairman?
I guess generally speaking, I don't have an issue with it. My only question or concern would be, is there any way, what's the age group of the participants?
It is going to be from youngsters to seniors.
Well,
a variety of different
that's my only
individuals.
My only concern would be is if you know, more likely a high school age individual were to do some chalk art that was offensive.
Oh, that's a good point, and I will talk to him about that.
You know, I don't know. I don't want to try to defend offensive, but you know, whatever.
Yep,
it's like substantial.
That's right.
Council, go to the allowing him to do that.
Great. And that's pretty much it.
Okay. You should have your quarterly reports from Mr. Poulin and Mr. Hilton. And the only other thing we've got left to do is the non-public minutes.
Make a motion to accept the minutes of April 6th, non-public.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion or changes? Seeing none, I'll ask for the vote.
Council Levy?
I don't think I was here, was I?
Nope.
Nope. I will abstain.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council Zink?
Aye.
Council Nazaro?
Abstain.
Council Waterman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 3-0 with 2 abstentions.
Make a motion to approve the April 20th non-public workshop minutes.
Second?
Second.
Discussion or changes? Seeing none, Mr. Winowski?
Council Levy?
Abstain.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council Zink?
Aye.
Council Nazaro?
Abstain.
Council Bodman?
Abstain.
Chairman LaBranch?
Ooh, you weren't there?
Wasn't here.
Oh. Aye. So it's 2-0 with 3 abstentions, correct? Did I get that right?
3-0
with 2 abstentions.
With 3 abstentions.
With 3 abstentions. 6 with
303. Right.
Okay, I lost count.
We're winning.
We got one more to go.
May 4th.
It's the May 4th.
Make a motion to accept the minutes of the May 4th meeting.
Second.
Any discussion or changes? Seeing none, Mr. Winowski to vote, please.
Council Levy.
I think I was still campaigning.
You just didn't know front with your mittens on. Yep.
I had my mittens on.
Oh, brutal.
I did. Somebody was downstairs.
Council Bergeron.
Aye.
Council Zink.
Aye.
Council Nazaro.
Same.
Council Bodman.
Aye.
Was I here?
Yes, you were.
I was here. Okay. Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye. Motion carries 4-0 with 2 abstentions. Okay. Our next meeting is July 6th, 2011. Which gives us a couple of weeks off. I'll look for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
There's a second.
Does anybody want to know what's going on?
Yes.
I already do.
We are new.
3-0.
Oh, you're behind the schedule. All in favor of...
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.